Hey, everybody, this is Josh Apter from Manhattan Edit Workshop. I want to welcome you to a very special edition of Sight, Sound, and Story Live inside the cutting room of Sam Osteen. It's an incredible panel, and it's just a really unique take on our event series, Sight, Sound, and Story. A lot of you out there have probably seen a couple of them before. We've been doing a series every month for a while now, and I'm finally not sitting in Jason Banky's backyard to do them. Good, because it's about 14 degrees out, so I'm glad to be indoors for this one. But I always say it, it's never not true. Part of what we teach is very technical, about the interface in the instance of the editor, the artist's tools. You know, the paintbrush is a computer, right? Or a keyboard. But I always love it when we get to take some time out to talk about the why of editing and the aesthetics and the art behind the decision-making process. And who better to focus on than Sam Osteen, and who better to do it than Bobbie Osteen, who we always love to come in and talk to, usually a one-on-one or, you know, maybe a small group. But tonight we tried something new again, and we're talking to a number of different editors. I'm going to let Bobbie take care of all the introductions, the background. If you want to come on in, all you have to do is talk, Bobbie, and you'll be right here. And you can say hello real quick.
Hello.
I'm glad. Are you there? Before you take over the show completely, because I don't want to forget to thank Jason Banky and Janet Dalton, and of course you, Bobbie, and all the people behind the scenes who make it so easy for me to just leave my son's clarinet practice and run upstairs and do the events. But I also want to thank our sponsors, Ace, Zeiss, OWC, Shutterstock, Mike Valinsky for helping coordinate all of that. And anyone else who's involved with this one, forgetting, I apologize, but thank you. Because I think it's events like these that really, you know, it speaks to that whole other side of the process, and, you know, a lot of great insight coming your way tonight. So Bobbie, why don't you come on in? You'll have to speak for longer to take over the single. So go ahead, and I will recede into the background as I'm wont to do, and we'll get on with the event tonight.
Thank you, Josh, and thank you, Jason Banky from Manhattan Edit Workshop, and Jenny McCormick from American Cinema Editors and American Cinema Editors for making this possible. And I want to thank you all for being here to celebrate Sam and his work as an editor, a job he called the greatest job in the world, which is also the most underappreciated, in my opinion. But it was also great because Sam wanted to be an editor when he was a kid. He grew up in Burbank. He had a paper route at 7. And by 8 years old, he had bribed the studio guard at Warner Brothers to get onto the lot and sell papers. And he was wandering around seeing amazing stars like Jimmy Cagney and Betty Davis and Humphrey Bogart. And he also saw the set of Tangiers for Casablanca. And he hung out in the cutting rooms too, in the editor's building. And he ended up in one particular cutting room where he met Owen Marks, who was the editor of Casablanca and treasurer of Sierra Madre and other great films. He didn't know that at the time, but he saw him working at this upright moviola, running film through it. And he said to him, You guys get paid for watching movies? And Owen Marks said, that's right. He said, that's what I want to do. And it really became his dream. So he ultimately ended up in the print shop of Warner's. But the union, the editors union, was really closed if you didn't know anyone. So he was there for 10 years waiting to get his break. And as it so happens, Joel Cox, who became a very successful editor in his own right, was a messenger at Warner Brothers as well. And he said that Sam stood out because he was so sure of himself, so sure he was going to make it. So 10 years later, he did finally become an apprentice. He got into the union, but the problem is the union had this ironclad rule that you had to put 8 years in before you could become an editor. So then he became an assistant. He worked on some really interesting films for Alfred Hitchcock, William Wellman. He was always cutting under the table. He was so eager to learn all that time. And then finally he ended up on a movie called Peric. And he He also, by the way, in between Bill Ziegler became his mentor, and he worked on Auntie Mame and The Music Man. But on Parrish, he assisted Owen Marks, the editor he had met so many years ago, that who was doing Casablanca. Owen was much older at that point and passed away towards the end of that film. And Sam took over and started making the director's changes. And the director, Delmer Daves, who was a triple threat, he was a director, writer, and producer, was really impressed. And he wanted to hire him on his next film. The problem was he had 4 more years to wait before he could become an editor. It was heartbreaking for him. And Delmer Daves pulled every string he could. He called the heads of the studio and the union, and no one would budge. So what he said is, when you get your time in, I'll give you a picture. And Sam was frustrated and skeptical. But what was crazy was 4 years later to the day, the phone rang and it was Delmer Daves. And he said, "Are you ready now, Sam?" And Sam said, "I'm ready." The movie was Youngblood Hawk. It was made in 1964. Sam said Daves also told him after this movie in 3 years that he would be the best editor in Hollywood. Sam didn't know how he came up with that number, 3, but as it turns out, 2 years later and 5 movies later, he got hired for Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf, which is the first movie I'm going to talk about with a wonderful editor named Zach Staenberg. And it's the first of 6 conversations with 7 editors about movies and sequences they chose. I really enjoyed sharing stories with them and hearing all their fascinating insights and observations. And I really hope you enjoy it too. Zach, thank you for being here. I so much appreciate you, your participation in this panel honoring Sam. And I'm so interested for you to share what your impression was watching Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf again after many years?
After many years. In fact, to be honest, I haven't watched it, I think, probably since I was personally in college, you know? And I loved it. It was great to watch it again. And it just for fun, I sort of watched a bunch of other movies that Sam had done, not a bunch, but as many as I had time for right now. I watched The Graduate and I watched Cool Hand Luke. And just to sort of, because I've always felt he's such a marvelous editor. I've always felt when I look at movies he's done, I look at a lot of other movies I watch sometime and I feel like I would do this or I would do that. I don't feel that at all when I'm looking at movies he's done. I feel like it's pretty much what I would do. Considering when he did them, I don't know a lot about the history of editing in terms of who did what when, but I had this idea in my head that he kind of started, to a great extent, was one of the group of editors who started what we would now call modern editing. And I love that. I when I look at his work, I kind of feel a kinship with him. And I never met him, but I love watching it again. Yes.
It's interesting you made that comment because we have a mutual dear friend who you worked with, actually, and I consider my mentor, Carol Littleton.
Oh, right. Carol's wonderful.
And she said on this film, what Sam did was truly revolutionary, avant-garde, and innovative in its day, a new language in film shooting and editing.
Right.
So your initial response when you communicate with me was about, here we have a stage play. We also have a director who's never directed a film before, Mike Nichols, who was Boy Wonder on Broadway and a lot of stage experience. And your description of what this was as a combination of filmmaking and honoring the stage play, but also film language. And could you articulate that?
Yeah, I'd love to. obviously you're dealing with material because of what you just said about the director, as a stage director, essentially, he's dealing with some of the greatest stage material written in this century, you know, Edward Albee's play. It's just brilliant stuff. And he's gonna take care to honor that. But at the same time, I felt like between him and the editor and the DP, Sam and Haskell Wexler, and I just felt like I was watching great craftsmen apply their craft to take something while honoring its stage origins and making it cinematic. And I think that's a very, very difficult thing to do. It's easy to overlook or underrate, but that's sometimes in areas like that where you don't have the overt opportunity to be flashy. That's where at least people who really understand the work can really see really great people doing their thing. And I think I see that all over this movie.
I love when you said taking film out of its formality and kind of halfway between theater and realism. It's a very interesting. The way it played out, who knows what the film would have looked like, because I just want to give a little bit of backstory here. The original cinematographer was Harry Stradling, who was a very, who had been an old school cinematographer. And Mike Nichols wanted to do this in black and white, and he was not a fan of that strategy and was worried about, and he wanted it to be grainy. And he said, I spent all my career trying to perfect my craft and I don't want to do this. The other side story that Haskell Wexler told is that they had a screening of 8.5, Fellini's 8.5. He happened to be at the screening, Haskell and Harry Stradling. And Mike was enthralled by that movie and identified with it. And Harry Stradling said it was a piece of shit. And then Jack Warner, who's the head of the studio, with a studio film, told Haskell he had to do the movie instead of Harry Stradling. And Haskell said, I had an obligation to another director. And he literally said, if you don't take this, you'll never work in this town again. Meanwhile, Haskell Wexler was primarily a documentary filmmaker. He was quite overwhelmed by this task. And he said, this is a quote, he's not experienced in this kind of filmmaking, and I was trying to keep up with my own skill. But what's interesting, and he shot handheld, he did a lot of unusual things, which we'll see in the clip we show somewhat. And Sam actually was sort of a little aggravated because he said he took hours to light. And then he would say things like, now you have to cut here because he walks out of this light. And Sam said, why don't you light it so the guy can cross over in the middle? Yeah. So there were limitations too. But the sum total of it was this very innovative style of cinematography. And Sam sort of, his being a Hollywood craftsman and Sam and Mike Nichols being brilliant at staging, this sort of combination of the three elements created this unique piece of art, you know, and who knows?
And like, I think like most great movies, it's really hard to tell where one craft ends and the other begins. There's so much overlap between the directing craft and the editing craft and the cinematography craft in all ways. You know, they're just kind of making a constant dog chasing its tail circle. That's why it's always so hard, I think, to discuss things in detail. I mean, I notice things that I'm pretty confident, you know, happened in one way or another, but nonetheless, you really, really can't tell unless you were actually on the set. You don't know what the conversations were, if Sam was there that day making a suggestion, if some of the staging is really interesting. And I wonder if that came from Haskell or from Sam.
And also what not to use, which I can actually give you some information about the scene we're going to show. But the other thing is, Sam, this was their first film together. They had a 28-year career, which is kind of interesting in itself.
Right. I noticed that when I first started talking, I looked at it, and that's one reason I really was really interested in looking at this film. It's really, really interesting to look at a first collaboration like that. That is, in retrospect, you can see it's the first of a long collaboration. Go ahead.
Yeah, and also the evolution of how he got hired. So initially, Joan Harrison was hired because Billy Wilder had used him to be on the set with him helping lay out shots, which is actually quite unusual, but right. He did that with all of Billy Wilder's best films. Mm-hmm. If you look at the credits, Billy Wilder's credits, you'll see. Mm-hmm. And so Sam was going to be the handler of the film. So he's going to put the film together, but Joan Harrison was going to be on set. And Mike and Joan did not get along. Mike felt constricted by all the things, the information. He was trying to tell the story and he didn't want the input. So he ended up leaving. And then little by little, Mike started calling Sam onto the set. Like, will this go together? What do you think? And Sam had already had several years experience as an editor at Warner's. And also he had cut under the table in the 8 years from apprentice to editor, which was the union restriction there. Right. So he had a lot of experience before the mic. And he was also careful not to step on the toes of the cinematographer, but just give input. So the other thing is
I always look at every film as a sort of an ephemeral combination of the people behind the camera, in front of the camera, when it was made. I always like to say, even a great movie, if you took exactly the same crew and put them together a year later, you get a different film. And
exactly,
so,
yeah.
I just want to elaborate on something you're saying in my mind. I'm sure Sam was very careful not to step on Haskell's toes, but at the same time, Haskell was probably openest things because he hadn't really done a movie like this before.
Right. And also, you know, was the times, this was 1966, this was what's often called the Hollywood Renaissance. This was the beginning of the breakdown of the studio system, the independent filmmaker. And it really was the beginning of, you know, innovation in cinematography, sound, and editing, which elevated the role of the editor. Right. And in fact, the next movie they made, The Graduate, was the first time an editor got single card credit, meaning Sam.
I didn't know that.
And Dee Dee Allen, Bonnie and Clyde. So it was also the beginning, you know, it was like you said, it's this lightning in a bottle of all these different elements and the time. Right. And Mike had an incredible amount of freedom. He had a lot of rehearsal time. He was able to, when they were shooting in the house, Sam was keeping up, so he was able to ask for things when he needed them. And the other thing I wanted to say, and then we'll start to talk about this particular scene, but when Sam went in for an interview for the job, the first question Mike asked is, can you shoot overlaps? Because he, coming from the stage, he wanted the realism of overlapping dialogue. And this is a story about a couple that is basically fighting all the time and overlapping. So Sam's answer was, if you shoot it, I can get it together. Now, whether Sam didn't have a plan at the time, he just thought, he was a confident guy, and he just thought, I'm going to figure this out. I mean, I get it.
Relate to it 100%. That's exactly what I would have said.
And the other, and Mike's response was, oh, that's interesting, because the other editors said they couldn't do it. Mm-hmm. So then what happened is his initial idea was to shoot with two cameras, and that would be an easier way to do overlaps because you have the two separate tracks. But Richard Burton didn't want to do that. Mm-hmm. So then what Sam did, and this was really ballsy in the age pre-digital, because it was with film, this is very, very difficult to do, and you can't make changes basically. So he basically took, and you totally understand this, and I know you do this yourself, but at the time, he took clean tracks of each of the actors, say George and Martha, which is Richard Burton, Elizabeth Taylor, and he dubbed them, he mixed them on the mixing stage. And then obviously when they're on screen together, the overlapping isn't a problem, but when you're cutting to close-ups or two shots or whatever. So he had this track that he mixed of them constantly overlapping. So, and he coded it so that the track and the picture were always in sync. So whenever he wanted to cut to either one of them, they would always be in sync and the overlaps would be there.
Right.
And, you know, it's, if there, he couldn't go back to the soundstage and fix all these problems. I mean, in the digital age, there wouldn't be repercussions to this, but Carol actually said that, you know, in today's world of digital equipment, cameras, mics, editing platforms, we have much more flexibility. But anyway, that's what he did. And you totally got that.
Yeah, of course. I mean, essentially what he was doing, what he was doing was exactly what goes on in digital, but it was just way more time and labor intensive to do it on film.
I mean, no one had done it.
I got to know a little bit Jerry Greenberg, who was started out as the assistant for Dee Dee Allen. And we talked about this a lot with Dee Dee, where she would make, she was like the dupe queen. She would dupe films, she would make a scene, she would dupe it, recut it, dupe it, recut it. And that's a lot like seeing keeping versions in the Abbott. It's way easier, but a creative person who's intent on doing that could still do it in film. And that's the sort of what you're saying Sam was doing in terms of how he used and how he solved the sound problem, because that's exactly correct. I mean, and what he's essentially doing for anyone who in the audience who didn't quite understand what you're saying is he's using, he probably didn't take clean tracks, what you said. He probably was taking an existing performance he really liked.
Right.
And essentially using it as a loop line and putting it into Richard Burton's mouth or Elizabeth Taylor's mouth or George Siegel's mouth at the appropriate time. And you can get in there between the syllables and tighten things up and actually put it in sync.
It was relatively clean, but not completely.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah. And
it's a lot easier to do that again with digital technology, but it's very doable in magnetic track technology, which is what Sam was using there. Yeah.
And he said, you know, basically he said the whole movie was a can of worms. Like that was the hardest thing, that it was just went on and on and on. It just didn't stop. Right. I want to, before we run the clip, you made a very interesting observation about how the style and pace was very carefully constructed and how there was a buildup in terms of that, the style of shooting and editing, and how, just to set up this clip, what happened before and how different it was to where we are getting to now. Can you explain what the beginning of the movie was before we get
to 30 minutes in? So. I noticed like the film begins on, clearly it's, I'm assuming this was planned by Mike Nichols. And Sam also liked it. Very, very long tracking shots. I mean, I think the very beginning shot, if I remember properly, starts taking Elizabeth Taylor and Richard Burton out of a university building, like they're coming from some event, and tracking them down, panning. I think it starts panning over from another building to that building, comes down, somehow goes back to that other building. It's a very long shot. And it continues in that vein through the house and through the whole bedroom. But at certain points, in rhythm with the screenplay, or with the stage play, I should say, really, which became the screenplay, very subtly start shortening and tightening and building. and that's what I love about it. I love that. And, you know, there's something that I'm assuming this is something that Mike Nichols really wanted to do, but the editor has to really understand this and know how to use it. I'm guessing, even when we're seeing like a two shot of Richard Burton and Elizabeth Taylor, they're like often on sides of the frame looking at each other. I'm guessing there was coverage on those scenes. And they're great performances, but being an editor doesn't mean you have to edit. It doesn't mean you have to make an edit. It can also mean knowing when you don't have to make an edit. And that's a super important idea.
That was the most important thing. It's so interesting you say that was to Sam the most important thing. Well, the courage not to cut.
Right.
And that working, don't.
It's totally, totally true. And you see it all through this movie. And basically, I was thinking to myself watching it, I would like to do that. And I have done it, but it's harder these days. I mean, you know, people push back against it more. I think Sam was really lucky. I think, first of all, the period of time in which he did the bulk of his work was, in my opinion, my personal opinion, the greatest time in American filmmaking. And you could argue there's other great times, but it's certainly arguably one of the greatest times in American filmmaking.
The combination of what was happening in the world of film, in terms, like I said, the breakdown of the studio system and the auteur director, the influence, yes, of foreign films, right, and also the increasing sophistication of technology. Yes. But it's interesting to note. So we're going to start this clip in a moment. I just want to say, the cameras were really heavy and cumbersome. So there's a moment that you'll see when Richard Burton is leaving the scene and walking down the hallway, which is something you couldn't show on a stage play. That was a small French 35 millimeter handheld camera, which is something that wouldn't happen in a studio film normally.
Yeah, probably shot it with an Arri or an Eclair.
I'm just quoting him, so I don't know, but
French camera,
small French 35 millimeter camera.
Right.
So let's run the clip. So this is where we're about to. Do you want to set up the clip? Because this is when she comes downstairs and she's dressed up.
You want to set up the clip?
Yes, if you'd like.
Okay, let me see. I've got to get to
another. Or I can do that. I can do it.
Okay, you do it.
Okay, so this is, they're a couple and they clearly have a very contentious, strange relationship, you already see. It's very late, there's been a party. Her father's the president of the university and he's a disappointment to her as, I think he's an associate professor. Right. Now this young couple, one of the young professors and his wife are invited over after the party. There's already been a lot of drinking, it's late at night. We get a sense that this happens a lot, that she brings the hot young professor over with the wife. There's a similar scenario that happens frequently. So they're just talking and then suddenly Elizabeth Taylor disappears and now the scene starts and we can play.
Just to elaborate your setup a little bit, what's interesting is she at first disappears with Sandy Dennis, the young wife.
Right.
And she takes her upstairs. And then Sandy Dennis comes down by herself, leaving Elizabeth Taylor still upstairs. And she reveals some stuff that Elizabeth Taylor told her about, which is we don't know if it's an imaginary or a real son that Elizabeth Taylor.
Thank you. Richard, yes. Burton. And so the stakes are raised already emotionally.
And you can see there's actually quite a nice cut there where you see the surprise on Richard Burton's face. He kind of clocks the surprise and then he shifts gears. Like, okay, it's almost, you can understand him thinking, it's like he's talking in his mind to Elizabeth Taylor. He's saying, okay, you want to play this game? Let's play this game.
Yeah, I was just going to say game on.
Yeah, game on.
And now it's double game on.
And then we come into the clip where he's already setting up the game to the young couple, and Elizabeth Taylor enters the scene.
And so she...
He knows that's what she's going to do. Because like you said, it clearly intimates this is not the first time this has happened.
Exactly.
But I think we also understand as sophisticated viewers that every time you play a game like this, you kind of raise it up a little bit. You know, it gets a little more intense. You know,
it's reflected in the style of filmmaking too, which we will see.
Right.
Martha is changing, and Martha is not changing for me. Martha hasn't changed for me in years. If Martha is changing, it means we're going to be here for days. You're being accorded an honor, and you mustn't forget that Martha is the daughter of our beloved boss. She is his right. arm. I was going to use another word, but we leave that sort of talk to Martha.
What sort of talk?
Well, now. Why, Martha, your Sunday chapel dress.
Oh, that's the most attractive. You like it? Good. What the hell do you mean screaming up the stairs at me like that?
You got lonely, darling. You got lonely for the soft purr of your little voice.
Well, you just trot over to the barry poo
and make your little mommy a great big twig.
That's right. Say, you must be quite a guy getting your master's when you were, what, 12? Hear that, George?
12 and a half, actually. No, 19, really. Honey, you needn't have mentioned
I'm
that.
I'm proud of you.
I'm very impressed.
You're damn right.
I said I was impressed. Beside myself with jealousy. What do you want me to do, throw up? That's really very impressive. You should be right proud.
Oh, he's a pretty nice fella.
I wouldn't be surprised if you did take over the history department one of
these days. Biology department.
Biology department, of course. I seem preoccupied with history. What a remark. I am preoccupied with history.
George is not preoccupied with history. George is preoccupied with the history department. George is preoccupied with the history department because
he is not the history department, but is only in the history department. We know, Martha. We went through all that while you were upstairs getting up.
That's right, baby. You keep it clean. George is bogged down in the history department. He's an old bog in the history department. That's what George is. A bog, a fen, a GT swamp. A swamp. Hey, swamp. Hey, Swampy.
Yes, Martha. Can I get you something?
Well, sure. You can light my cigarette if you're of a mind to.
No. There are limits. I mean, a man can put up with only so much without he descends a rung or two on the old evolutionary ladder, which is up your line. Now, I will hold your hand when it's dark and you're afraid of the boogeyman, and I will tote your gin bottles out after midnight so no one can see, but I will not light your cigarette. And that, as they say, is that.
Jeez. Hey, you played football, huh?
Well, yes, I was a quarterback, but I was much more adept at boxing, really.
Boxing? You hear that, George?
Yes, Martha.
You must have been pretty good at it. You don't look like you got hit in the face at all.
He was intercollegiate state middleweight champion.
Honey.
Well, you were.
You still look like you have a pretty good body now, too. Is that right? Have you?
Martha, decency forbids.
Shut up. Was that right? Have you kept your body?
It's still pretty good. I work out.
Do you?
Yeah.
Yes. He has a very firm body.
Have you? Oh, I think that's very nice.
Well, you never know. You know, once you have it...
You never know when it's going to come in handy.
I was going to say, why give it up until you have to?
I couldn't agree with you more. I couldn't agree with you more.
Martha, your obscenity is beyond human.
George here doesn't cotton too much to body talk. Paunchy here isn't too happy when the conversation moves to muscle. How much do you want?
155, 150.
Still at the old middleweight limit, huh? That's pretty good. Hey, George, tell him about the boxing match we had.
Christ.
George, tell them about it.
You tell them, Martha. You're good at it.
Is he all right?
Oh, sure. See, George and I had this boxing match a couple of years after we were married.
A boxing match? The two of you?
Oh, really? Yeah, the two of us, really.
I can't imagine it.
Well, it wasn't in a ring or anything like that, you know. Oh. See, Daddy was on this physical fitness kick. Uh-huh. So he had a couple of us over one Sunday, and we all went out in the back, and Daddy put the gloves on himself, and he asked George to box with him.
Yeah.
And George didn't want to.
Yeah.
So Daddy was saying,
come on, young man, what sort of a son-in-law are you?
And stuff like that. And while this was going on, I don't know why I did it, I got into a pair of gloves myself, and I snuck up behind George, just kidding, and yelled, hey, George, and let go of this roundhouse right.
You're just kidding me.
And George wheeled around real quick and caught it right in the jaw. Pow! He caught it right in the jaw. And he was off balance. He must have been. And then he landed flat in a huckleberry bush. It was awful, really. It was funny. It was funny. I think it's colored our whole lives.
Oh, you're dead.
I think I watched it like half a dozen times just thinking about talking to you. And every time I watch it, I see more stuff. You know, it's really, I think it's a pretty brilliant piece of filmmaking. Honestly, I really, really do.
Yeah. I mean, one of the things I just want to say is that, for example, the shot where she lights the cigarette lighting, which is a pretty, you know, pretty out there shot. Mike did not like that shot. And Haskell thought it was fun to experiment, do this out of focus thing, and Sam used it.
Yes.
And also this whole thing about—
I don't know if you noticed, you said she lights a cigarette. It's George Segal's hand.
Yeah, right. Yeah. But I'm, yeah, exactly. And
which I love, because it's also giving you a lot of character. I mean, I find that it's sort of like Swampy, hey Swampy, you know, so he comes over to her and totally disarms her, saying, what can I do for you? And, and she's taken aback by that. She loses her footing for a second. She doesn't know what to do. And she kind of searches for something for him to do, since you can light my cigarette. And he turns it on, anything but that. There's no particular reason he shouldn't light her cigarette.
Yeah, it's just they're playing mind games all the time.
Just playing the mind game. And then George Segal's character is not immersed enough in it yet. And he's also somewhat probably sexually aroused by her. And he's kind of looking to flirt very subtly with her, you know? And so he likes it.
Yeah. But also there was a lot of, you know, when these scenes, there's sort of a depth of feel where you can really see everything going on with the three characters on the couch. And Haskell Wexler did shoot numerous close-ups that Sam didn't use. And of course, saving the close-ups and those extremely uncomfortable tight shots, and, you know, it just, you see the combination of sort of somewhat conventional coverage and then these very ballsy, like tight close-ups. And the beauty of the film is that in the stage play, when he leaves to get the gun, you don't see him at all. Right. So, and that's the handheld camera I was talking about. But yeah, it keeps, not only are the characters on edge, but you're on edge by the nature of the filmmaking. And, and you know, like I said, you don't need to do the close shots except for emotional impact, because the way Haskell shot it, there's so much information in those master shots. I mean, you see Sandy Dennis in the background. And
I was wondering, in like that raking three shot on the sofa, was that a split play after, do you know? I don't know how they got George Segal and Sandy Dennis both in focus.
Oh, no, he said
it's just a long lens with lots of light.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. I was wondering, because I couldn't see, I don't know if your audience knows what a split diopter is, but it's a device that allows you to put two things that shouldn't be in focus in the same shot.
Yeah, no.
Detect a line, and I didn't see that line.
No.
So I was thinking he probably just put a lot of light on it.
That's what he did, yeah.
And I think Sandy Dennis is a tiny bit buzzed, a little tiniest bit out of focus. But, and this is where that whole overlap of what I was referring to earlier, of the different crafts of directing and editing and cinematography comes in. Because first of all, I think in so many ways, Sandy Dennis is the unsung hero in this clip, because she's really working.
I mean,
she's just great through the whole thing. Her reactions, or essentially the audience.
Yeah. And he did, I just want to also say, Haskell Wexler did talk about mistakes he made. And he said, oh, I lost focus here. You know, so some of that stuff is just, but it almost has a documentary feel to it, which adds to the immediacy and the emotions of the movie.
Yes.
We have to wrap up. I'm so sorry.
I just want to go back.
There's one final thing you want to say.
I just want to explain what I said about my favorite cut. Okay. And my favorite cut is when Richard Burton whips his head around when Elizabeth Taylor first shows up. And the reason it's my favorite cut, it's because I'm an editor. And it's clear to me that was not planned. That was a purely editorial decision. I actually looked at that really carefully. And first of all, we talked about how the stakes were raised when Game On, we talked about that moment. And then what Richard Burton, according to the editor, was not expecting, and I know this in retrospect because I watched the scene now, but that's why I say according to the editor, what he's told me that what Richard Burton was not expecting was her to come down dressed like that. That caught him by surprise. And that cut tells me that 100%. And what I love about it is it's clearly an unplanned cut. It was unplanned by the director and it was unplanned by the cinematographer. And the reason I can tell that is if you or your audience look at that cut, look at the first frame of that cut. It's a bad cut. It's not, in terms of classic editing, it is a bad cut, but it's a great cut. Basically, you're in the three shot or the wide shot and Richard Burton's head is the right way. You're basically cutting to like the side of his head with his nose cut off, just cutting to like the, and but his head whips and it's a cheat, but it totally puts you in, it totally shifts the gear of that scene. It's just great. I just want to say.
So thank you so much. I love the specificity of that. I really appreciate it. It's great. And
many other things in the scene that are like that, but that, you know, when you're looking at a scene, you never know quite what happened where, but to me, I could just imagine making that cut myself and showing it to the director, showing it to Mike, and he being a little taken aback and saying, well, I'm not sure, and then watching it a few more times and eventually falling in love with it, you know?
Yeah, the element of surprise is the greatest gift an editor can give to a director.
Yes.
Thank you so much, Zach. I really appreciate your insights and being part of this. Thank you.
You're very welcome. It's a real privilege. Thank you.
Thank you. Michael, welcome.
Thank you, Bobbie. It's great to be here. Great to see you.
I'm so honored that you're going to be a part of this.
I am honored to be a part of this.
We're talking about a little known film called The Graduate.
Yes, indeed.
And I'm curious initially to ask you about the first time you saw it at 14 at the Lincoln Arts Theater on West 57th Street in New York.
That's correct. Yes. And, you know, I think I was probably too young to see the film. And as I was thinking about this conversation, I was thinking, well, what kind of films did I know at the time? What did I watch? And, you know, it's interesting because Sean Connery recently passed away, to remember that I was watching James Bond films. And also growing up in New York, I used to watch a Saturday night show with my grandparents called Saturday Night at the Movies. And they owned the Universal catalog and they were showing these great Hitchcock films. So I was watching Rear Window and Vertigo. So I was watching pretty good films and I had seen some Frank Capra films. And I think I probably was exposed to some high quality, but what I didn't realize, I think, until I saw The Graduate was people made movies. There was the hand of artists doing this thing. And there were a few things that made me feel that. And one was the seduction scene, because we're rolling right along and it's kind of like a normal movie that I would have been watching at the time. And all of a sudden, in the background, in a reflection, Mrs. Robinson closes the door. And Ben turns his head once, and then again in rapid succession. And I don't even know if I knew I had seen exactly that, but it was so powerful, and it wasn't like anything I'd ever seen. And then later in the, shortly thereafter in the film, there's the scuba scene, and that was really powerful for me. And it's something that has stayed with me to this day, because it was my introduction to first person point of view in cinema. Now, true, I had seen it in Rear Window, right? But not in that way, and not for the same reason. And it wasn't until many years later that I realized that putting us in Ben's head through the scuba mask and with just the sound of his breathing inside the scuba suit, when we are looking out through the mask, it made us identify with Ben. I mean, we literally identify with him. We are him. We're seeing exactly what he sees. And that, I believe that Mike Nichols and Sam used that technique to make Ben, who's really a reprehensible guy, acceptable to us. In fact, I don't think it occurred to me for years and many viewings later that Ben was reprehensible.
Becomes a stalker, basically.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, first he has an affair with the wife of his father's business partner, and then he stalks Elaine.
I think it's so great that you talk about the how much you're inside his head, because it is true that first third of the movie, first of all, you feel for him because he's way over his head and Mrs. Robinson is way ahead of him. And he's such a victim, such a spider in her web, you know, and I mean, a fly in her web, and she's a spider. But it's even just the way the movie starts, and it's just this very unconventional shot of him on the moving walkway at the airport, and he's a piece of baggage basically, but just the way he actually cultivated Dustin Hoffman as an actor, this stillness, but it's not, he's doing something all the time. You're feeling, you're inside him in a very clear way. And even at the party scene when his family is, you know, the claustrophobia of all those people, and the sound is not natural. It's just somebody reading from a yearbook, but it's all, he's in a vacuum of, and we're with him in this vacuum, and in his bedroom with the aquarium and the suffocation theme, and the you're suffocating with him, you know?
Yes, and he's underwater, you know, whether it's in his own bedroom or in the pool or everywhere at that point in the film.
And I had mentioned to you that I have the line script, so it's basically like having dailies, which is an incredible luxury. And I actually didn't have it or study it until after Sam had passed and after I'd interviewed him. But one of the things I discovered is the opening of the movie was originally an amphitheater where he's graduating and he's giving a speech about the themes of the movie. And it's not necessary because he lives it. He lives the themes. And I'm worried about my future. And as you said, plastics, all you need.
Well, it's true. And I think, you know, that's such an interesting thing with all editors, but I didn't know about this. Then where you look at your first assembly and wonderful sound designer, Randy Tom, calls this the 100% rule. Everyone working on a film feels 100% responsible for getting the themes and the character and the story right. And so you wind up with a bunch of redundancy. It's why first assemblies are so difficult to watch. And it's true. I mean, you get it from the graduation party, and particularly plastics. Okay, I get it. You told me actually also about another lift that amazed me, where Ben is at the bottom of the pool and the camera pulls back to his family's outdoor barbecue, and then to many, many outdoor gatherings on a Sunday afternoon in the suburbs. And again, we didn't need it. We get what suburban life in the mid-1960s were. You know, was like, and
yeah, and also there's a line when he's in the airplane at the beginning, and she says, "You're now descending into Los Angeles, ladies and gentlemen." Yeah. Mike said that was statement of theme.
Yes,
he was, you know, the social commentary on what he called the Los Angelization of America, and yeah, the parody of people around their pools also you'll really notice it when we run the clip, but it takes you away from being inside his head too. And there's very, very few moments, there are some, and I'll even point out one that we're gonna see where it's not his point of view, but it's almost always his point of view. And the power of that takes you through the ride of the film, and you stay with him, even though, as you said, he's a complicated, not totally sympathetic character. And the other thing in terms of the style and the control, Sam was on the set through the entire shoot. So you had Bob Surtees, who was a veteran camera cinematographer, and Mike and Sam were all creating these transitions and these shots. And Mike was very influenced by foreign films, particularly 8½ at that time. And so you have this avant-garde cinema combined with conventional, you had Hollywood craftsmen, which were Sam and Bob Surtees, and then you had Mike's influences that was in our culture, the culture at the time too. Foreign films were really making their mark on independent filmmakers. This was the new Hollywood, what some people call it. So it's also, you know, the language is so cultivated to express not only theme, but character, you know?
Absolutely. And what's been fascinating for me, thinking about this conversation and rewatching these scenes, is that these, for me at the age of, the graduate for me at the age of 14, became my French New Wave cinema and my Fellini, and it opened me up to what I would see subsequently, pretty shortly thereafter. But yeah, this was, you know, again, in terms of what I was watching, there was nothing like this. You know, watching in the seduction scene, the shot where Ben goes downstairs to fetch the purse. I mean, it's endless. And I noticed something, speaking of French New Wave, I'm pretty sure there are two invisible jump cuts in there. First of all, I'd never seen anything, Woody Allen did this later on, but I had never seen a film that held on a master shot after the only character in it had left the shot.
Oh, I want to tell you something about that. I'm so glad you brought that up. So from studying the line script, they had footage of him leaving to get the purse. You see him get the purse and come back. And I thought it was an interesting choice that Sam didn't use that, because it's also the comedy of it, of the empty room and his coming back in. And it just, and I also wanted to say in general that from studying the line script, I was really surprised to find out that there was a lot of coverage that Sam didn't use. And his first cut pretty much didn't change. So I think what happened, and a lot of that was, and it's preceding the first clip we're gonna show actually, where they're in the den and he's kind of pressured to drive her home and he's very uncomfortable, and clearly she has an agenda, which he's not totally aware of yet. And all of that was a lot of, they had anamorphic screens, so they had wide shots, they had power positioning, there was these beautifully composed master shots, and there's virtually no cuts. They just, as few as possible, and the average shot length in this movie is 17.8 seconds, which is extremely long. Most movies, the average shot length is 3-5. So
And by the way, in the scene that we're talking about, you know, that average, it's brought down to 17.8 by the one frame and two frame cuts when Mrs. Robinson comes into the bedroom.
And I want you to talk about, because, and then we'll show the clip, but you said something so great that really has something to do with it. So the scene we're about to show has 16 cuts in 30 seconds. That's a lot of cuts. That's a lot of fast cuts. But if you didn't have this slow buildup, it wouldn't have the impact. So the scene in the den, which really takes its time, and of course, one of the reasons I think Sam resisted coverage is because Mike Nichols was a master at staging, and they had the work of the cinematographer and Sam blocking out these shots. So the mise-en-scene was so perfect, why mess with it? But I love what you say about the difference between pace and rhythm, because it really plays out in what we're about to show and what preceded it.
Yeah, and it's true, and it's something that teaching editing, I talk about a lot with my students, that your pace is basically how slowly or quickly a scene unfolds and how slowly or quickly you tell your story. But rhythm is different, and varying the rhythm is so powerful. And you're right. I mean, we've been holding in shots for a very long time when suddenly we hit the three head turns. And so the impact is so much greater because it's a brand new rhythm. It's, you know, it changes everything. And then, of course, the flash cuts. And, you know, it's interesting what registers. I remember when I first studied editing and got into editing, the common wisdom was you needed 8 frames to perceive what you had just seen. And then later that became 6. But it looks like there are some one frame cuts in there, ones and twos.
I think there's 3 frame.
Ah, okay.
But that's sure. And let's run this scene, because then we can talk further about specifics and then we'll have seen it.
Sure.
So let's run Sounds it. Great. Thanks.
Benjamin, I am not trying to seduce you.
I know that, but please, Mrs. Robinson, this is difficult.
Would you like me to seduce you?
What?
Is that what you're trying to tell me?
I'm going home now. I apologize for what I said. I hope you can forget it, but I'm going home right now.
Benjamin?
Yes?
Will you bring up my purse before you go?
I have to go now. I'm sorry.
I really don't want to put this on again. Won't you bring it up?
Where is it?
On the table in the hall.
Mrs. Robinson?
I'm in the bathroom.
Well, here's the purse.
Could you bring it up?
Well, I'll hand it to you. Come to the railing and I'll hand it up.
Benjamin, I'm getting pretty tired of all the suspicion. Now, if you won't do me a simple favor, I don't know what.
I'm putting it on the top step.
For God's sake, Benjamin, will you stop acting this way and bring me the purse?
I'm putting it here by the door.
Would you bring it in to me?
I'd rather not.
All right. Put it in Elaine's room where we were.
Right. Oh, God. Oh, let me out.
Don't be nervous.
Get away from that door.
I want to say something first.
Jesus Christ.
Benjamin, I want you to know that I'm available to you. And if you won't sleep with me this time...
Oh, my Christ.
If you won't sleep with me this time, I want you to know that you can call me up anytime you want and we'll make some kind of an arrangement. Did you understand what I said?
Let me out.
Benjamin, did you understand what I said?
Yes, yes, let me out.
Yes, I find you very attractive. And anytime you want, you just...
Oh, Jesus, that's him.
Yes, sir.
First, I just wanted to say something that Sam had talked about when he was editing this. He said, originally I had close shots of her face, nude shots of her breasts and belly, and close shots of Benjamin reacting to her that Mike had selected. But when I cut the scene together, we both decided it wasn't funny. We couldn't figure out why. So I experimented. First, I found an outtake of Benjamin reacting that was shot from behind Mrs. Robinson over her shoulder. It was the only angle where a part of Mrs. Robinson's body is on screen with him. I decided to use only that outtake whenever I cut to Benjamin so that the audience would always know where what he was looking at. I didn't need to cut to Mrs. Robinson's face at all. Since I wasn't locked into using conventional cuts to establish her, I could play her dialogue off screen. I was free to experiment. I used subliminal cuts of her breasts and belly. So anyway, whenever he looks at her, he's not looking where he's supposed to. Like if it's her breast, he's looking down. If it's her belly, he's looking up. And it doesn't match. And he said, because the only thing he was concerned about was the Benjamin's performance and his escalating panic. So he was picking performance rather than matching, which is a good editing piece of wisdom anyway. But he said that because you never saw her face when she's proposing the affair, she's like disembodied. It's surreal and it makes it funnier. And also you don't need to see her face. It's another editing rule. You need to see his reaction because the beauty of his performance and the nature of the scene is what makes it funny. And I just love that, you know?
Yeah, it's so insightful. I'm gaining such great insight into what he did. I sometimes quote one of the very first directors, I think the very first director I was ever paid to edit for was Andrei Konchalovsky. And he asked me why I had made a particular cut. I said, oh, I cut on motion. And he said, he loved English. It was his second language and he loved it. He said, don't cut on motion, cut on emotion. And in a way, what Sam does in that scene is exactly that. Yeah. Because Ben, if we see him making eye contact with Mrs. Robinson, really it's only because he can't really stop himself from looking down. So he's looking at her, but then we cut around and we see, oh no, he's really looking down. And it's the head swing
like you, that you responded to as a 14-year-old. I mean, it's so every take he's progressively looking more and more a certain direction until the third swing he's looking directly at the screen. Of course, that's not real. And so but it's an emotion. It's the emotion of I can't believe this is happening. And you triple take in your heart or your head. You know, it's not real.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah, so, but I just think that there were 22 shots they shot. They covered, you know, they were worried about it. So, and Sam used hardly anything. And that's another good piece of wisdom. Don't feel you have to use everything. I mean, there was actually a shot of her body against black velvet. I have no idea why they shot that. But like bulging eyes and shots of her face, you know, lots of shots. And yeah, like you said, unnecessary. So I think that the evolution of that scene is so interesting and not necessarily obvious, but like, why isn't something funny too? You know, how you have to analyze it and try to hopefully figure it out. So so I want to talk about the scuba scene.
Yes. Next. Before we do, I just want to mention one last thing about that great shot from behind Mrs. Robinson down the stairs at Benjamin, and then he leaves frame, and then he leaves frame. I'm pretty sure that, you know, and this is a wonderful thing, that as you study a great editor and great work that a great editor did, you learn is, okay, so Ben goes off and we're on this empty frame, and presumably he goes off and finds the person. Now, I don't know where that was off stage, but I'm sure that time was manipulated there, that Sam did make an invisible jump cut to get him back into frame so that we're not simply waiting and waiting and waiting on the empty frame. And yeah, that was just all so great, so great. But yeah, let's move on to the scuba scene.
Yeah, okay, so I'll just say what happens in between. So you see him in the den with Mr. Robinson, and it's of course incredibly awkward because Miss Robinson comes down stairs and there are three of them are there, and this just happened and his mind is exploding, but he has to keep it together. So now he leaves the house. And what we're going to see is they do a lot of experimentation and avant-garde stuff in this movie, conventional and avant-garde, but they do a lot of extreme pre-lapping. And you were asking me about this particular pre-lap, Michael, and this was in the script. So this pre-lap was, but the one that we're going to see afterwards is not, and we'll talk about that. But let's just run the scene and then we'll talk about it.
Ladies and gentlemen, your attention, please, for this afternoon's feature attraction. Hey, over there. Yes, I mean you. Your attention, please. Are you ready in there? Feature attraction.
Could I speak to you for a second, Dan?
Listen, now I'm going to ask for a big round of applause to bring this boy out here, all right? Now, wait a minute. Oh, let me amend that. To bring this young man out here, because today he is 21 years old. Just hang on a minute. I've got a few words to say.
Yes, you always do.
Oh, look who's talking.
Dad, can we just talk about this for a second?
I can't hold them much longer, Ben. You better get out here.
I'd like to discuss this.
This young man is soon to continue his education as a Frank Halpingham Award scholar. But before he does... You're disappointing them, Ben.
Dad, can you listen?
I'll give you 10 seconds. He is going to give us a practical demonstration of what I feel safe in saying is a pretty exciting birthday present. And it better work, or I'm out over $200. Okay, then, let's hear it now for Benjamin Braddock! Perform for you some spectacular and amazing feats of daring in water that is over 6 feet deep.
I don't quite know how to put this.
Benjamin.
Look, I was thinking about that time after the party.
Where are you?
And I was wondering if I could buy you a drink or something.
So first of all, I love that you pointed out the sound, the nature of the dialogue between the father and son when he's inside. Can you talk about that?
Yes, it's, you know, it's one of these things that brings to mind something Jerry Greenberg used to talk about. He said, you know, things that in other areas of life are not good in editing are really good. And They are things like stealing and cheating. And there's this major cheat. And I must have watched the film easily half a dozen times, maybe more than that, before I ever realized there's this massive cheat. When right before and including the reveal of Benjamin in the scuba gear, that he and Murray Hamilton, or he and Ben and his father are having this conversation at the door. And as we listen, of course, the person on the other side of the door can't be in a helmet. It doesn't sound like he is, and he's hearing everything his father says, and they're just carrying on, and we assume without thinking about it that Ben is right there. And then the door opens, and that reveal again is emotionally so perfect that we don't even notice that Ben is way at the back of the room, fully suited up with the helmet on.
And it's so, it's like Nichols and May. It's like a comedy routine, you know, it's all done for comedy. And yes. And it's again, surreal, it's not real. Very little in that scene is real. No. But it's just the timing and the fact that they're equal makes them a dueling sort of comedic dialogue. And that's the point rather than making it real. And of course, the other thing is they did shoot wild tracks. There's natural sound that they could have used because they had it when he's in the scuba gear walking to the pool. And instead, again, surreal, you're in his head. He's suffocating. The real sound of the people at the party would take away from that, you know?
Yeah, absolutely.
And the parents were singing happy birthday to him and they recorded that, but you don't want that. You want to be with him.
Yeah.
And you want to be drowning, suffocating.
No, it's true. And that theme really plays well. And the sound there enhances that tremendously.
And then there's a great cut, the invisible cut, from going above water. If someone wants to play around and look at it, it's pretty good.
Yeah, I wondered about that. Is that because they needed somehow the shot in which you see the flippers could not work as the submersion shot, or?
I just think they were just trying to make it look like one, you know, continuous.
Yeah.
And not notice it, because that wasn't, they don't want you to notice it. They want you to follow him in. And then it may be my very favorite thing Sam did in the movie editorially is, and we touched on it earlier, is that when he's at the bottom of the pool, they actually shot all this with helicopters and everything. They originally were going to do a pullback out of the pool and to 30 other houses with swimming pools and make a comment about suburbia. And then the way it was going to go is, then you hear the sound of Ben breathing, you fade into the sound of the wind, which is something they were going to use in the movie that they never used. They were using sound of wind. It's very Fellini-esque, by the way, but they didn't use it. But anyway, they sound of Ben's breathing, hold for a few seconds, then the sound of a dime dropping into the phone. And so there was no pre-lap there at all. So instead of this helicopter shot, they go right from this extreme pre-lap. There's quite a bit of dialogue of his calling Mrs. Robinson before you ever see him in the phone booth. And what Sam's comment about that was, he was drowning and desperate. He was at the bottom emotionally, physically and emotionally. And this gave him the impetus to call. So by pre-lapping it, you really like put a spark under that impetus. And I just love that. It's like such a ballsy, like interesting thing to do, you know?
It is. And so many great ideas get introduced there. First of all, for me, again, as a 14-year-old, whether I was aware of this or not at the time, ultimately one has to be aware that film has a metaphorical aspect. And when you're looking at someone at rock bottom, underwater, drowning, it means this character is hitting rock bottom and he is underwater and he is drowning. And And that was fantastic. And that cut is a very, that deletion is a very interesting thing to me, because it does another thing that keeps you identified with Ben. Because in addition to showing literal POV shots, and we're about to, you know, have a POV shot of moving POV of Buck Henry and looking down at the table, and Mrs. Robinson appears as Ben's life metaphorically is upside down, and all that stuff happens. But really, the important thing is it continues to make the film a film in which we only know what Ben knows. We don't see anything he doesn't see. And had we come out of the pool and come out into the neighborhood, that spell would have been broken. So it's a brilliant cut. It's a really brilliant cut.
So just to sum things up, I just, is there anything else you would like to say about the film overall in terms of how you see it as an editor and what?
It's a bottomless well for me. I can go back to it anytime and relearn important lessons and learn new ones and see things I'd never seen before.
Why do you think it's timeless?
I think it's timeless because it's so specific. It's, you know, I think we learn this over and over again. When you try to be universal by being general, you miss by miles. But when you are very specifically about this moment in time and this moment in the way on the West Coast in Los Angeles, and very much about what recent college graduates were starting to feel in 1967. And
everybody feels those things still, and that alienation and the questioning, and it did capture the zeitgeist of the time, but that to a degree will always be there, and people will always identify with Benjamin. And, you know, Benjamin was in a way Mike Nichols. He didn't realize he was casting himself. Thank you so much, Michael. Your insights were invaluable as an editor and a wonderful teacher. And I really appreciate you.
Well, thank you, Bobbie, for having me and for your amazing insights as well. And I love talking about this great, great film with you.
Thank you.
Edited by a great, great editor, truly.
Thank you. Kelsy and Leanna, thank you so much for being here.
Thank you so much for having us.
Yes, thank you. This is so exciting.
And I'm really excited to talk about Rosemary's Baby through your eyes, because you're a whole different generation. This movie is 52 years old, just kind of crazy. Wow. I want to talk what you two have in common is, you both studied film in college, of course, different paths. Kelsy, you studied at Manhattan Edit Workshop, which is where you really discovered your passion for editing. Manhattan Edit Workshop is producing this event. So that's pretty amazing. And Leanna, you knew you wanted to be a film editor. You went to film camp, which I
did.
And you studied in high school, also studied editing. So, but then what you both have in common, your lives converged when you became ACE interns, and your backdrop is from EditFest, ACE EditFest, which is great. And that I call that the golden ticket, because it's such an amazing opportunity to shadow assistants and editors in all different genres. So I just wanted to ask you before we start talking about Rosemary's Baby, what you got from that experience? What was the most valuable thing you learned? Kelsy, I'll start with you.
We just learned a lot of the workflow that the assistant editors have, you know, on a day-to-day basis. And we also spoke with some editors, and they just talked about you know, what they do on as editors, as storytellers, and that, you know, sometimes people just don't truly understand what editors do. And the more you think about the job, the more it's just so fascinating of how much control and with the story and the performances of the characters. So a lot of the people also advised us, you know, when you start out, you always need to have a very positive attitude with wherever you go. And that really just helps you get ahead of yourself in your career. So everything was just so valuable.
And you had incredible hours of Zoom meetings instead of having people.
Exactly.
Leanna, what would you say was...
Well, actually, I would say it's the hours of Zoom, because we were actually able to meet over like 100 different mentors, and they were just editors and assistants and post supervisors, like all across the industry. So now, you know, now that we're actually coming into our like early career, we now have a whole network of people that we can reach out to and ask advice from. So for me, that has been like the most valuable thing.
And they really come through. Editors are wonderful mentors. They remember where they came from. They know the challenges, political and creative, right?
That you yeah, for sure.
A lot of political.
That's something that you just have to balance. It's not just the technical or the creative, but it's also the other side.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So this film we're going to talk about, Sam's first film with Roman Polanski. It was actually edited by someone else, and there were problems, and they asked Sam to take over, and they were breaking down the film. It was over 4 hours long. And you don't actually know this story, but it was taking forever. And Roman didn't want to stick around for that. He was actually going on his honeymoon with Sharon Tate. He left the country. The producer said to Sam, I'll give you a bonus if you just start cutting and put 6 reels together, which is about an hour, by July 4th weekend. So he just started cutting. Wow. And then Roman came back from his honeymoon and he said he couldn't believe that he started cutting without his permission. He said, what did you do to my picture? And Sam said, I cut half of it. No, at that point, a fourth of it, I guess. And he said, well, let me see it. And so he ran it and he was so happy. He just said, keep going.
Wow. That's
yeah.
Awesome.
And they had a very respectful, but passionate like relationship in terms, and he would keep saying, why are you taking all these scenes out? And then the next time he'd take more out. And what was interesting about the combination of Sam and Roman, I think, is that Roman is a European film. His style is more sort of languid and lets it play out like a lot of European filmmakers. And Sam has this sort of cut to the chase American way of working. And I think the combination of them allowed for both of those qualities to let the film breathe, but also have pace, you know? Mm-hmm. So it's kind of an interesting. So I wanted to ask you, what your experience? Now, first of all, Kelsy, you don't like horror movies, so you'd never seen it.
So. People have suggested a lot, because I was back in film school, I wanted to do a short films related to dreams and sleep paralysis, and a lot of people recommended to me to watch Rosemary's Baby, and I wanted to watch it, but I just, horror films are just a no-no for me, but. But this film, I felt that was very, it's more about the psychological. And what you said about like that European style, it's not so explicit that they're showing, you know, very gory, like blood or supernatural effects. It was just all in your imagination, sort of, so.
Yeah, I mean, it's there really isn't very much violence in the movie. It's just what it does to your heart and your soul. And how about you? So Kelsy, you had seen it twice. Did you see it more the second time? I mean, Leanna, I'm sorry. Did you see it more the second time as an editor and first as an audience? And if so, what was that like?
Yeah, I watched it in high school. So that was a long time ago. And I wasn't looking at it in terms of like the editing and the cutting. And so, you know, after having like a film education and, you know, speaking with editors and like learning how to think like an editor, I watched it through that lens. And it just made me realize like, it's a lot of longer takes. And I think that it's important that like in this film, like you see that they made the decision of when not to cut and when to let the emotions and the performances just play out.
Yeah, I mean, the courage not to cut is a big deal. And it's often one of the mistakes young inexperienced editors make is feeling like they have to cut, and cutting is showing off or, you know, flourish. And sometimes the power of when something's working to just let it play is a very good sort of learning curve as an editor, and also not using everything that was shot. And speaking of that, I wanted to tell you that I have the line script of Rosemary's Baby, which is like dailies. So I did see that that Roman shot a lot more footage than Sam used, and we'll talk about that a little bit. But I wanted to start off by, you both picked a specific scenes, and Kelsy, I wanted to ask you first. So why did you pick the scene you picked, and what, and then we'll play the scene and talk about it further.
Sure. So this scene or this sequence happens right after Rosemary suspecting, you know, her neighbors, the Cassavetes, to be kind of, they belong to this satanic coven. And so she starts to tell her husband, Guy, and he kind of discounts her suspicions. And so she tries to tell her doctor, her own physician, Dr. Hill, about them. And so this is when we find out if he believes her or not. And I chose this scene because I just loved how the tension is built. And, you know, the choice of staying some shots a little bit longer. And during the time when we feel the tension, the cuts are cut a little bit more quicker. So the pacing changes over time. And
this whole thing about, which is also something Hitchcock did, subjectivity and objectivity, like this is a very powerful first person point of view that you're in Rosemary's head most of the movie. Right. But there are occasions where the audience is ahead, and that creates suspense too, which comes up in the second clip. But I just wanted to mention that. And something I talked to you both about, which is also interesting, is that by seeing it through Rosemary's eyes, what Polanski intended, and actually the book intended, is that there would always be the possibility that everything that's supernatural that happened in the movie was a figment of her imagination. Which is crazy because most people don't see it that way, but there is that possibility because all the supernatural stuff happens in a dream state or a recollection of a dream state. But it is the power of, like you were talking about, Kelsy, like just how the camera angles like make you stay, you're with her. So this is an hour and 20 minutes into the movie, approximately. An hour and 52 minutes into the movie. The movie is, this is very close to the climax. So we'll run the first clip, please.
I was sleeping.
With us quietly, Rosemary. Don't argue or make a scene. Because if you say anything more about witches or witchcraft, we're going to be forced to take you to a mental hospital. You don't want that, do you? So put your shoes on.
We just want to take you home. No one's going to hurt you.
For the baby, put your shoes on. She's fine now. We've got to go home and rest. The That's all it takes. Thank you for your trouble, Doctor.
I'm glad I could be of help, sir.
It's a shame you had to come in here.
You promised them the baby.
No, I didn't promise them anything. What are you talking about? Promise who?
Rosemary, you're a
man. You too. Get away!
Is.
The babysitter.
Do you know where she went?
They went to the movies.
This is Rosemary. Please ask her to call Rosemary the second she gets home. It's terribly urgent. Don't forget, hmm?
Don't worry. I'll tell her.
Thank you.
We don't want to hurt you, Ro.
We're your friends, Rosemary.
There's nothing to be afraid of, Rosemary. Honest and truly, there isn't.
There's nothing but a mild sedative to calm you down.
You know, I wouldn't let anyone... Oh. Ro! Ro! Ro!
Help me!
Oh, Ro, baby.
Somebody help me!
Wait a minute now. We happen to be in labor here.
Here?
Here. You're going to be all right, baby. You're going to be perfectly all right. I swear to God.
It was supposed to be Doctor's Hospital.
Please don't.
Doctor's Hospital.
You're going to be perfectly all right. I give you my absolute word.
And everything clean and sterile.
Oh. No, she isn't here, Elise. I'll have her call you back.
Oh, Andy. Andy or Jenny.
I'm sorry, my little darling. Forgive me.
First of all, just to say before this, to me, that when she wakes up in the doctor's office is the most devastating part of the whole movie, because you think she has this meeting with this doctor and you think she's safe. And then she wakes up from the nap and she's in a normal doctor's hands, and then they're there. And I was telling Kelsy that by looking at the line script, there were a lot of different angles when Saperstein comes in. And so what he used, so there were shots of Saperstein's face when he was talking to her and telling her to come with him. But, and there were shots of close-ups of the slippers, of the pills, of shooting past Rosemary down the hallway. But this looming torso of Saperstein, where you never even see his face, yeah. And this fragile girl, it made her so, this threat of male masculinity and this conspiracy against this fragile girl. I mean, how did that, make sense to you that?
Yeah, I mean, that particular shot just kind of allowed the audience to sympathize with her, and we could see her reaction. You know, feeling very fearful and defeated. And yeah, having that shot just kind of, you know, a little bit low angled and just seeing his torso just feels like he is a little bit in power and she's powerless, and very effective.
Yeah, and even there, the way they appear in the doorway, you know, it's the empty doorway, mm-hmm. and then the, and I wanted to talk about, even though we're not showing it, it's a very iconic scene where she's in the phone booth and she's making the call to this doctor. And that scene had multiple camera coverage. Like there were all kinds of angles. And what Sam said about it is, this is the whole subjective versus objective thing. And so in that case, he didn't want to cut because you think she's safe. And if you cut, you're cueing the audience to know something before you want them to. Whereas mm-hmm. if she's in the phone booth and the back of you, what you think is Saperstein's head behind her mm-hmm. just appears, you're not ready for it. So the scare factor is better.
That makes sense.
And then the scene we're gonna talk about next is a whole different style of cutting. But even at the end of the clip you chose, that you have this fast cutting style because you already know she's in danger. So that kind of style heightens what you already know, you know, so exactly. It's like different. And I just wanted to also tell you, just you see it in the clip we just looked at. So the way Polanski shot scenes is he would never have a solid master scene, a static master scene ever. You would maybe have a shot that was kind of inclusive, like a master scene, but you would have people move out of frame or the camera would drift a little. There was always movement. And so Sam said, in order to cut in close, it was really challenging. It was like jumping onto a moving train, but it also made his film so alive, you know? And so Sam said, his film speaks to me so loud to me, whereas others, it whispers to me. You know, it just, he loved it. But now there was also, supposedly he did that so studios could not interfere as much with his cut, because it's hard to change that. Once Sam put all those difficult puzzle pieces together, it was mm-hmm. hard to change it. I asked him directly about that and he denied it.
But, oh, really?
But Bob Willoughby, the set photographer, said it was very clear to him that that's what he was also doing. But it was also just an incredible style because it keeps you unsettled, you know, that whole.
Sure. Especially when the scene at the end, when they all come to get her and it's just a little bit closer shots and the entire, and I think because the closer shot just feels a little bit more claustrophobic and as you said, the handheld motion, you know, it would be a different feeling if it was just static, but the handheld just made the audience feel like they're in the experience with her as well.
Yeah, and he said that when previews, like especially when she's walking down the hallway, which we're about to see, but other things too, even when she's walking down the hallway of her apartment and the scene, He said audiences of previews would go like this, like,
wow,
trying to look around the corner because you really, you're so like, I'm here, I can do that, right?
Yeah.
In the corner. So, and I also just noticed that I love when the music stops when mm-hmm. she's in the apartment. That's very interesting.
Right.
So the thing I was talking about, letting the audience get ahead of the character. So that one moment where you see the people tiptoe in the background and she doesn't see them, that's the kind of moment. Hitchcock did that too. So like for one Rear Window, which is all Jimmy Stewart's mm-hmm. point of view, there's one moment where you see the bad guy, Thornwald, leave his apartment and come towards his apartment. He doesn't see it, only the audience does. So that whole, that's such a great way to create excitement for an audience. You know, it's very Hitchcockian kind of thing.
Yeah.
So anyway, let's go on to the next clip because we're almost there. So what happens after the first clip, Leanna, to your clip?
Okay. So in between, she has the baby, she wakes up in the bed and they are giving her these pills and they're also like pumping her milk out and she's wondering like, why are they doing this? So she starts to like fake taking the pills and she like puts them in the wall so people don't notice. And then she starts to wonder like, is the baby still alive? So they're taking her breast milk and you know, where is it going? So there's one clip where like she has like a dirty spoon and she tries to put it into the container with the milk and like, no, don't do that. So this is when she's starting to be like, okay, I'm going to find out what's actually going on. And this is when she gets up out of the bed and we see what happens.
Great. And then we'll talk about why you chose this clip and your insights afterwards. Yeah. Let's run the clip. Thank you.
Thank you. Rosemary, go back to bed. You know you're not supposed to be up and around.
Is the mother?
Rosemary.
Shut up.
Rosemary.
Shut up. You're in Dubrovnik. I don't hear you.
His father's eyes.
What are you talking about? Guy's eyes are normal. What have you done to him, you maniac?
Satan is his father, not Guy. He came up from hell and begat a son of mortal woman.
Hail Satan!
Hail Satan!
Satan is his father, and his name is Adrian. He shall overthrow the mighty and lay waste their temples. He shall redeem the despised and wreak vengeance in the name of the burned and the tortured. Hail Adrian!
Hail Adrian!
Hail Satan! Hail Satan!
He chose you out of all the world, out of all the women in the whole world. He chose you. He arranged things because he wanted you to be the mother of his only living son.
His power is stronger than stronger.
Hail Satan.
His might shall last longer than longer.
Hail Satan!
No! It can't be! No!
Oh, look at his hands.
And his feet! Oh, God!
God is dead!
Satan lives!
So, tell us why you chose this clip, Leanna.
Well, this clip really just grabbed me, especially just like right from the beginning with the music. Like, she gets out of bed and you're just with her and then the music starts. And then when you see the keyhole and like the second that you see that someone's walking by, the music stops and she runs. And, you know, you're just with her and you're kind of like waiting to see like who's there. Guy comes in and he's just like going into the fridge. And you're like, isn't he worried about whatever's going on? Like everyone's acting so normally. And she's standing there with a knife and it's just so like ironic. Like you see like the cradle like rocking back and forth and she stops it with the knife. I think that's just such a cool moment. It's like you just don't put those two things together. And like when you just see her using a knife next to a cradle, it's like, what's going on? I also thought it was great that she went back to the closet, because in the first scene of the movie, like, when they first see the apartment, the closet's covered by like a dresser. And they're like, well, there's a closet back here. Like, what is it? And then like, as she's dismantling it, like you realize like, oh, like this is her escape. And someone else must have also used this as an escape. And they wanted to block it off so that she could not. And, you know, when she finally goes into the apartment, the first thing that you hear is Minnie's voice. And at that point, like the whole audience is tired of Minnie's voice as Rosemary must be. So you hear the voice and you're just like, oh. And she goes in and it's like everyone there is just sitting normally. And then you just see this like black cradle. And it just looks so odd in like the group of everybody. And the funniest thing, like when she goes over and, you know, she looks in, she sees the baby, the audience doesn't. And she says, what have you done with its eyes? And then it goes to like her point of view and it pans to Guy who's covering his face. So like, you know, I was expecting something weird to be happening to Guy's eyes right now. And I was not expecting the Satan twist, you know. Honestly, I thought that it was the witchcraft thing in the beginning, but it makes a lot of sense. And I just think that it's so bookended, like, you know, when she drops the knife, like when she realizes that like her plan's not gonna work, she can't do anything.
So, wow, that's so interesting. So did you guys think when she pulled back the curtain of the cradle that she saw the devil's eyes? What do you think? Did she see anything?
I don't know what she, I mean.
What do you remember?
From what I remember.
I did see the devil's eyes and then Yeah, you told us that it was actually a piece of film from earlier, from the dream sequence.
Yeah, so everybody, this is the power of suggestion and also the power of not showing something. It's so much scarier when you actually don't see something and your imagination goes wild. And so Sam's idea was, that was actually from the rapes, the when the devil rapes her. He just took a subliminal cut, and it doesn't come when she pulls back the curtain. It comes when she drops the knife from the floor at the very end of this sequence. But people swore they saw it because they wanted to, you know, they wanted to have something concrete. And I just thought our suggestion, you know, it's so interesting.
That was interesting.
An afterthought. And I also love what Leanna, what you said about the musical hits happening in the same rhythm as the cuts.
She goes into the closet and it's like, there's the hits. And like when the thing falls off the shelf, that's like on an offbeat. And then she's taking like off the towels, like as she's putting them down, it's a hit, it's a hit. When she takes off the last drawer, it's a hit. And then you're in the closet, you see the keyhole, you see out the keyhole, and now she has her plan. So it's like, the music is just like building with her as she's like figuring out what she's going to do.
Yeah, I love that. And the sweeps of the camera, just sort of, I mean, you also responded to that, all those pans back and forth and just what it does psychologically and how you're with her once again. I want to tell you something also interesting that I discovered in the line script. So, you know, when she goes into the closet and she pulls all the towels off and everything, and then suddenly you're kind of disoriented because all you see is a light bulb and you don't even know what it is. And you're straining to look, which is one of those things, again, evolving you as an audience, you know? So they reshot that because the logistics of actually taking the towels off and then, you know, it was probably tedious and not that interesting, and they lost the momentum. So I thought it was very clever that to get around the logistics of actually opening the closet, the back of the closet up, they instead disorient you with the light bulb. So it's kind of a cheat because you're not really seeing what's going on, but it also like, what's going on? What's going on? What? Where? You know, and then you find out. So, but yeah, the walk down the hallway with it. So when Sam was talking about heightening what you already know, he said, I cut to her feet, the knife in her hands, I hung on her, you knew something was going to happen. So that's where the cutting pattern came much faster there, you know?
Right.
And that thing where, that was the one where she's walking down the hall and people are like, what's... but the other thing when you mentioned about Minnie, and she's kind of a comical character and very not an obvious villain, people forget that Polanski's movies have a lot of humor in them. Even the way the people are tiptoeing in the background to get in, it's dark humor, but it's humor, you know?
Exactly.
Those characters at the end, you know, that are celebrating.
Yeah.
But so for you, I want to ask each of you, for you, did it feel modern? I mean, do you see anything that makes it seem like a movie that's 52 years old, or does it feel like it could meet? I mean, is there anything that would be done differently cinematically, or did it feel very modern to you?
I think it felt pretty modern. I like that, like, she was like a strong woman character. I think that if it was shot today, then, you know, like, my biggest question is like, you know, why didn't she leave? And that might have been different today.
Yeah.
You know, feeling trapped, like, you know.
Right.
Any person could be in her situation.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Right. But in terms of editing and cinematography, did you find that it felt modern to you?
Yeah, I would say so.
I mean, even watching it right now for the first time, I still felt very engaged and didn't feel that anything took me out. Because of just, you know, the camera movements and the editing and the acting, and the overall direction was just so on point and still to this day, still really good. Mm-hmm.
I'm so glad that you got the experience to watch it and share your feelings with me and your thoughts as young editors. It's just very interesting to me, and I'm sure for the audience. So thank you so much for doing this.
Thank you so much too.
Yes, thank you for having us. This is great.
Thank you.
Thank you. Take care.
You too.
You too.
Hi, Terry. Thank you so much for being a part of this.
Thank you. It's my honor. Anytime you talk about Sam's editing because he's a legend.
And you had a lot of thoughts about different things to talk about. You definitely are a fan of many of his films, but I really was touched and intrigued by your idea of talking about Day of the Dolphin, because it's not one of his most well-known and was not a success, and nobody even really wanted to make it. We'll talk about that. But what was interesting to me is your first experience seeing it was as a child. So can you talk about that initially?
Yeah, I mean, when we talked about participating in this, I really went and, of course, reviewed all of Sam's work. And, you know, I had forgotten that he was part of Day of the Dolphin. And when you look at everybody who was involved in making the film, it's just extraordinary. But I remember this movie so vividly, seeing it as a child. And I don't know whether it was one of those things where I was going to the movie theaters with my parents and it was, oh, it's going to be a movie about dolphins. But it was such a, I'm going to use the word traumatic experience, but not in the sense of the movie itself, but how emotionally it affected me when I saw it. And for those of you who have not seen it, it is a relationship film between on the surface, of course, it's a relationship film between men and mammals, but for me at that age, there was something just very visceral about the relationship between the characters and the dolphins. So when it came time to talk about Sam's work, I think because it had such an impression on me as a young person, I thought, let me go back and explore this film a little bit.
So now you explore it as a grown-up, but also as an editor. So what was it that struck you seeing it again, it from that perspective?
Well, it is what you always hope happens, which is you're able to, again, immerse yourself as an audience member. And of course, I had to look at it a little more analytically than that. But how effortless it is, in a sense, with respect to, you know, what it's really an editor's film. It's you know, directed by Mike Nichols, of course, and Buck Henry, the writer. But what Sam had to do with respect to building a relationship, creating a character, having dolphins become characters, and characters that you cared about and that you were invested in, and characters that are interacting seemingly with humans. And I, you know, look, we have a history of movies where we have, you know, Lassie and Benji and all these, but there was just something beautiful about how he was able to build these juxtapositions of imagery and physical connection with these characters. And I can't even imagine the amount of work that it took and the amount of footage he had to go through and build and create from, you know, dolphin footage and really building these mammals into, you know, characters that we would ultimately care about. And,
The evolution, first of all, the challenge of dolphins speaking and not being silly or hokey, For one thing, actually, Polanski was originally going to direct it. And he was on location, he was in London prepping it when Sharon Tate got murdered. So that was the backstory of directors wanting to work on it. But he was very concerned. He was thinking about using the blowholes for the dolphins because that's where the sound actually comes from. So it's right. A total cheat. And then he was concerned about it being silly. And, but also the way they introduce you to the dolphin speaking is very, very clever because there's very little of it. Do you want to explain like how they set it up? So it's not like suddenly they're talking and you're like, what?
I mean, it's very subtle. I mean, from the moment that the film starts and you start getting introduced into the world you're about to be taken in, again, you know, they start the film by George T. Scott's character actually talking to the screen. And as the film, evolves, you realize he's talking to a larger audience and he's giving us a speech about his research. And I think what's extraordinary is that you're kind of brought in to the world that he's created through his institute very, very subtly. And it really isn't until a few minutes into the film when he returns back to this island where he and his wife have their, their research lab, for lack of a better description, aquarium. Do you start to get a sense of the relationship? And, you know, he comes home and something has happened while he's been gone. And ultimately, when you start to finally bring him in to meet the character of Alpha, other known as Fa, it becomes suddenly an intimate moment between he and the dolphin, Fa, who ultimately you discover starts to, you know, say something very, very rudimentary to him. And by then you've gotten a sense of who he is. And so it doesn't really come off, and it's very, very subtle. It's a very subtle type of connection between them. And then it gradually evolves where you get a sense of exactly how intelligent Fa is. But I think that it was done in such a way and built in such a way so that it would not feel campy and it would not feel silly, but it would feel actually intimate and very simplistic in a way.
And also watching them swim together and the whole sensuous kind of connection they have, and it's very emotional. So you see the bond is not just that he's this idea of creating dolphins who talk and the whole intellectual part or cerebral part, there's this whole, he's a father to this dolphin. I mean, they don't have children. This is a couple who are marine biologists. There's Ma and Pa, they're called Ma and Pa. And it all sounds so corny, but
it does sound corny. It's like, for those of you who haven't seen it, you have to kind of just go in there and go with it. And but it really is, because you know they do a great job again at the beginning of introducing to you to how they ultimately adopted, how, you know, it's kind of one of these like Disney-esque kind of where Fowl loses his mother in dolphin birth, and they adopt this dolphin, and it is part of their family. And you're right. And then the other researchers that work with them, they've created this kind of community, this family community, with Fa being this, you know, the child character within this group. And no less, I love the fact that, you know, Fa as a dolphin is hitting adolescence and what comes with an adolescent dolphin. So
and how the parents deal with it.
And how the parents deal with it.
And it's all, I mean, there's two parallel threads that really, which is, it's a political thriller based on a book about how the other people who are connected with the government are going to want to use Fa for nefarious purposes for an assassination. So they're intertwined throughout the story, but a lot, and certainly that's editorial too, in terms of creating tension and making the audience understand. But on the other hand, in terms of Sam's work, the really beautiful stuff is the montage and shaping this relationship.
Yeah. Yeah, shaping the relationship, especially at the beginning between, George C. Scott and Alpha. And then ultimately, yes, as the story unfolds, he has this profound responsibility as editor of juxtaposing, you know, what's happening to the George C. Scott part of, you know, family, as well as the nefarious people who are trying to use the dolphins for very evil purposes. And then you have Fa and his newfound mate Beta, B, who are kind of between these two worlds. And, you know, there's this part of the film where you're just with them for a moment. And it's just, you know, again, to Sam's credit, he just goes all in and creates these incredible inner cutting of you know, all three in trying to build this tension as to what is going to happen in this film.
Let's run the clip and explain, like, this is, because this was a wonderful moment in where, can you set up what's happening just before the clip?
Yes. So as we talked about, Alpha is becoming an adolescent and seemingly needing some female companionship. So they decide to bring Beta B into his life. But then as a result, Fa stops talking, which, you know, was not, you know, was, you, we know George C. Scott was not going to have any of that. So they decide to separate Beta and Fa to try to get Fa to come back around and communicate with his parents again. So that takes us into the clip.
Thank you. This fowl wants me. Maggie? Maggie? Maggie?
Love this clip so much because as montage goes, it's kind of for me a perfect example of how you juxtapose imagery to tell the story of the relationship between Dr. Terrell or Jake, which is George C. Scott, and Fa. And I just love the idea that this building petulance of his almost like a father-child relationship, and how difficult it is for Jake to experience this moment and just as we get further and further into the montage, how Sam just tightens up, even that you get so used to the sonic rhythm of Fa going in circles and hitting the side of the tank, and even how as he's going around, you know, the way that Sam is, you know, pushing further into Jake, and at the same time having these great cuts of Fa, and then at a certain point, you know, he's cutting away to the other members of the family. And with those hits in the distance and how they're reacting and how you're using the characters and the images to kind of mark time, even when you have one of the researchers literally marking in the sand how long this has been going on. And so in that sense, it's just really beautifully done. And then ultimately, again, when we talk about creating a character from an animal, from a mammal. At the end of it, when you see Fa's character just watching Jake from the poolside and making the decision that he's going to relent and he's going to finally talk, which is what the whole purpose was. I think that it's something where it just feels to me effortless, and that's Sam. And so ultimately when, you know, when Jake finally gets what he wants and he lifts the barrier, and then George De La Rue's music comes in, you know, it becomes this musical celebration on both parts, but just again, taking us from our human characters into recognizing that the dolphins themselves have their own agency in this film. And so the celebration that Sam creates is glorious. And what's fascinating about the George De La Rue score is that theme, which you can call the almost like alpha beta theme, is very, very prevalent throughout the film. And especially when we get into the tense later in the tense parts of the movie, he still uses that kind of underscore of them to kind of, with the other musical elements. So I don't know. It's just, it's such a, I know it's a dated film, and it wasn't something that when it came out, it was exceedingly successful. But when it comes to looking at what we do as editors in all types of films, which is bring our audience into a story that ultimately they care about the characters. I mean, Sam had to do some incredibly heavy lifting here. And I think that he did a beautiful job with the film. And, you know, sometimes the films that we sometimes do the most, you know, incredible work on aren't necessarily the ones that always get seen. We all, you know, but when you're in the process, you go all in. And that's how it feels to me when I watch this film.
And I love the found piece of where that very close shot of Fa's eyes, and they're glistening, and it's water. It's not tears, but we put that into it. We put our emotions into it. I'm sure he loved finding that. And just yeah. Before he speaks, and it's the most emotional moment when the dolphin is, as a human, making a decision to give Georgie Scott the gift of speech again and connect with him again. And also just the escalation of the dolphins under the water, out of the water, and just out of the water at the end, and just those sharp cuts.
Yeah.
So beautiful, you know.
And there are a few places within this film where Sam actually took out dialogue, where he let, whether it was atmospheric or musical, or, but where you actually don't have any dialogue within moments that are happening in the film. Where typically you would. And I thought it was a really kind of brave and incredible choice in the places where he just let, whether it be the sound or the music, kind of take these moments. And it's fascinating because both sound and music got nominated in this film.
Yeah, and the other thing I have to say is, so Buck Henry was the one who created those sounds. But Sam, when he needed a lot of emotion and it wasn't there and what Buck Henry recorded, he recorded it. So a lot of, there's another editorial contribution is he did Fa Once Be Now For Me, and it was pretty amazing.
I was going to say, when you watch the film, could you tell which one, could you tell when you heard him?
That's a very good question. I'll have to look at it again and see if I can, but he really did a good job of it. And you know, it doesn't match. It's like when the mouth open, it's one of those things where you go with it, you know, it's that wonderful suspension of disbelief. Mm-hmm. And ultimately I love what you said, that Mike Nichols had an obligation to Joe Levine as a 3-picture deal to make this movie. Buck Henry was not the ideal person to write a political thriller. He even admitted that he would have liked to have some more narrative help, and it wasn't totally successful in that aspect of it. And it was neither here nor there, not a Disney movie, not a really evolved political thriller. But like you said, Sam was into it. He was into the process. That's what editors do. It doesn't, all your work, like as you said so beautifully, Terry, it's not a function of how successful it is, what you got from it or what you gave to it. And I think that's a really important part of being an editor, and a beautiful part, that maybe Mike and Buck weren't into it, but Sam was into it.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
And I think that with the vocalization of the dolphins, I mean, I went back, and if you go back and watch the film, and I hope you guys do, on the Blu-ray, there's a commentary with Buck Henry, and he talked about, you know, in adapting the book, that the dolphins actually were more conversational. I mean, they actually were more advanced in the book. And so the idea to kind of dial that back and make it very simplistic. But I also think what helps was that Sam really worked with the sound people to allow the actual natural sounds of the dolphins to be a huge part of the sonic landscape. So it wasn't as if suddenly, again, you had the dolphins just kind of speaking, but there was a lot of other kind of sounds and, you know, vocalizations and sound effects that they use that I think help kind of give you this blended feeling, and so that it didn't come off as too silly or campy. And it's not like you have the dolphins talking to one another. You
that's
know,
really
I mean,
true. No, that's yeah. really true. And they stayed, second unit stayed for 6 months afterwards to give Sam things he needed, sound and dolphin mouth openings. And so he did have the luxury to play with a lot of material too.
Yeah.
And then at the end,
Oh my God. I mean, I think that was the thing when we talk about the thing that was the most memorable for me, you know, from this movie is the end of this film. And I think that's what's stayed with me. And again, even as an adult, I mean, I know that, you know, often when you see a film when you're young, especially if it's something that there's something in it or potentially emotional in it or traumatic in it, that it can stay with you. I mean, that's part of filmmaking and being children and how we retain things. But to go back again and watch it as an adult and still feel that sense of, I'm of course going to blow it for all of you who I hope go see the film. But there is a certain, the end is very sad.
Well, it's okay to talk about it. We're okay. going to do spoilers on this whole panel. Yeah. He has to let the dolphin go because they're going to be used. You know, he's created a monster in a way. He created something that could be used for evil. And so he has to let them go and keep walking and not look back and make them leave and say, Pa is not.
Yeah.
And there's the dolphin in the foreground crying, Pa. And, you know, and he has to not look back at him. And it's so poignant. And I just want to tell a little ending story for this because it's not about editing, but it's interesting how wonderful dolphins are. So they were working with trainers and they go back in their pen at night because they wouldn't ever just let them go and put them in the wild after all this time because they were not raised in the wild. And so when the final shot happened, which was this end of the movie, the assistant director said, that's a wrap. That's the end. And the dolphins, both dolphins, the primary dolphins, jumped over the fence and never came back. And they knew it was over. And they were worried that they wouldn't adapt to the wild, but that the fact that they knew, and also George C. Scott got in a fight with his wife, really bad fight, Chris Van Der Veer's co-star, that they never saw. And after that, Alpha would not go near George C. Scott again. He sensed something and they had to use a devil. So dolphins are amazing.
They are amazing. They are an incredible, incredible species and we could learn a lot from them, honestly.
And thank you, Terry, for choosing something. I just love that you chose this because it is so much of an editor's film and it speaks to that what you had just spoken about, which is look at all the editor's work. Don't wait till they have a hit movie, you know, or after they've had a hit movie and they do a movie that's not considered successful, because an editor is usually rises above all of that and just wants to do their best work. And that's right. One of the beauties about editors, the purity of the editor.
we are relentless.
Thank you so much for being part of this. Thank you. Oh,
my pleasure. My pleasure.
I appreciate it. Darrin, thank you so much for being here.
Of course.
For this panel honoring Sam. I really appreciate it.
Thank you for including me. It's a real thrill.
So I have an easy first question for you.
Yeah, okay.
Why is Chinatown your favorite movie?
That is, it's not an easy, as easy a question as you might imagine. I don't know. It's probably the first movie that I began to think of that way as a kind of adult person. And when I say adult, I mean past a kid. I was probably a teenager, you know, when I had probably seen it two or three times by the time I was 18. And just could never turn it off if it became, you know, if it came up on cable or wherever. I was fascinated, and I'm from Los Angeles, so the depiction of LA history, as fictionalized as it was, but still connecting to real stories about LA's history, and then just the I'm a sucker for tragedy, and just being drawn into both the mood and frankly the darkness, you know, the bleakness of it, spoke to me very, very early on. And you know, there are probably a handful of movies that I would consider quote unquote my favorite movie, depending on the day, but when asked for a specific, Chinatown is always the one I'm going to name check. Yeah.
And I love that you say you like movies where we can't outrun the darkest part of our past. I love that you said that, and also the history of LA, not just this particular water scandal, but just the you described it as sort of this broken
a broken city, a city that will probably never really function as elegantly as great cities of the past that we think of as great cities, and part of its, you know, part of its appeal for me, and part of why I continue to live here, is to sort of watch this flawed experiment in Western expansion and capitalism just sort of run its course. I don't know why that's appealing to me, but it is. And the thing that Town and Polanski did so beautifully in Chinatown was to interweave that sort of corrupted history with the corrupted history of a family, you know, the crosses. And I'm stuttering now saying it just as she does throughout the movie. She can't say father without saying father. The very bleak story that they tell of this sort of generational betrayal and horrible abuse that seems by the end to show no promise of ever being resolved, of ever going away, just runs parallel to this story of why LA has been doomed from the beginning to be subject to the role of financial special interests, and it's a terrific movie in every respect.
And it was interesting about how the style of it was. Polanski's intention was to capture the look, which was so beautifully captured, art direction and costumes and et cetera, but of the era of Maltese Falcon or Double Indemnity or whatever, but saw it through the camera eye of the 70s. And it was very much Polanski's camera eye. Mm-hmm. So the other thing I wanted to talk to you about is I think we should run the clip and then get into a lot of things about how it was shot and how it was edited and talk further.
Yeah.
So do you want to set up the clip?
This is, this comes sort of right at the, without analyzing it too much, probably right near the transition from the second to the third act. It features Jake Giddes and Evelyn Mulray at her home. It's really three scenes in a row, or two and a half scenes in a row. It's a little sequence that has, and this has always been the part of the movie that affects me the most deeply. They have gotten to a point where they're maybe beginning to trust each other a little bit. Jake still suspects Evelyn of something, but he's begun to question exactly what it is he suspects her of. And they come together and begin to let their guards down when, just a little bit, when he needs his wound redressed. And she tends to him in the bathroom, and then they wind up in bed, as they did in the 1970s cinema.
Is there anything you want the audience to watch out for? Do you want to just discuss the editing and cinematography afterwards?
The thing that I found interesting, it was at your suggestion that we're going to include the first of the three sort of separate scenes here, which is them out on the deck. And I think it's interesting that that first scene seems, the camera work feels very designed. Like Roman had some very, very specific camera placement and moves in mind. It was had the kind of the blocking of the characters and the movement of the camera seemed very much to be choreographed. And so my guess, and I'll never really know, maybe you know better than I do, is that that scene was cut precisely as Polanski had imagined it would be when he shot it. And sometimes as an editor, that's clear. You get the footage and you know exactly what you're supposed to do with it because the director had thought it out so clearly. The next is basic in the bathroom is pretty much just over the shoulders of the two characters facing each other, which really gives the editor a lot of freedom as to where to make those cuts and really play off the actors' faces, which Sam is doing in that scene. The thing that I noticed watching it last night was a really, really beautiful match cut that I'd never really clocked before, going from the first scene to the second scene as they're leaving the little courtyard in the house and going in to get the supplies to dress his nose, where he cuts, their bodies are crossing the frame at the exact same position where the bottle of peroxide is that she's grabbing off of it is a perfect example of eye trace. Your eye doesn't have to move a millimeter to just follow the action. I thought that was beautifully done. And of course, I've seen it 20 times and really only clocked it last night. It was gorgeous. And then the third part is in the bedroom, which will be, I think the portion of the scene that we're going to include is just a single one-er. Later on in that scene, which we won't get into, there is more coverage on that scene, which really makes it clear, or at least apparent, that the choice to play the first minute or two of the scene in the one-er was a choice. Like they probably had coverage for all of it and just chose to use the overhead because it was just so good. Anyway, that's it. And
that's really great. I love that we can watch for these things that you're telling them because you did it so beautiful for me before. And I love that. And I want to tell you something else that is so interesting about, I think everything is true that you said, but the other little side note to that is that whenever he shot at a tremendous amount of takes, more than Sam had ever experienced with any other director, but they weren't dramatically different from each other. It would be an inch to the right or an inch to the left or a tilt to the head or holding the cup differently. So those were the unusual choices rather than should I cut to that close-up or that two-shot. It was more of this refined sort of pre-visualization that Polanski often did, but with these tiny changes that the editor could just have a field day with.
Right. But then, of course, you're also dreading the question from the director in those situations. Well, why did you use this take?
Yeah.
Two takes later, he's 4 inches to the right. Why didn't you use that one?
Well, you know what he loved to do, according to Sam, was he loved to go back and forth over every single cut and then maybe change it and usually put it back to the way Sam had it, but he just had to keep seeing it and trying. Yeah, he really knew editing very well, but he did also say Sam was usually right after he argued vehemently about something. So let's run the clip.
Let's run the clip.
Maid's night off.
Why?
What do you mean, why? Nobody's here, that's why.
I gave everyone the night off.
Easy, it's an innocent question.
No question from you is innocent, Mr. Gittes.
I guess you're right. To you, Mrs. Mulray. Frankly, tonight you saved my... You saved my neck.
Tell me, Mr. Gittes, does this often happen to you?
What's that?
Well, I'm judging only on the basis of one afternoon and an evening, but if this is how you go about your work, I'd say you'd be lucky to get through a whole day.
Actually, this hasn't happened to me for a long time.
When was the last time?
Why?
It's an innocent question.
In Chinatown.
What were you doing there?
Working for the district attorney.
Doing what?
As little as possible.
The district attorney gives his men advice like that?
They do in Chinatown.
Why did you leave the police force?
Do you have any peroxide or anything like that?
Surely. You come this way? Is it painful? Mm. It must be painful. What's wrong?
Your eye.
What about it? What?
Something black in the green part of your eye.
Oh, that. It's a flaw in the iris. It's a sort of birthmark. You really don't like to talk about the past, do you?
Tired.
Well, why does it bother you to talk about it?
Bothers everybody that works there.
Where?
Chinatown, everybody. To me, it was just bad luck.
What?
You can't always tell what's going on. With you.
Why was it bad luck?
I was trying to keep someone from being hurt. I ended up making sure that she was hurt.
Cherchez la femme. Was there a woman involved?
Of course.
Dead? Don't do anything until I get there. I have to go.
Where?
I have to.
I want to know where you're going.
Please, don't be angry. It has nothing to do with you or with any of all of this.
Where are you going?
Please. Trust me this much. I'll be back. There is something that I should tell you.
I love the way you describe how tragic that the end of that scene is, and by staying on that off-center shot of the pillow, the empty pillow in him, that you mm-hmm. see him transition to his most vulnerable, to just mm-hmm. starting to close up.
Right.
Knowing the full impact of the phone ringing, but you see him just as his most vulnerable there. And if there had been more, if Sam hadn't just stayed with that and not relied on, you know, gotten mm-hmm. away from that moment, you wouldn't have experienced it. It's very subtle, you know?
Mm-hmm. And of course the next shot, even though he moves into it, is a direct POV of her naked back, which puts us back in the mode of most of the movie, which is him as an investigator, you know, not as, you know, him trying to find the truth. And so, and so much of the movie is simply shot from his perspective, his literal perspective, his exact perspective or his near perspective. And in that moment, he's back to work because—
And she's back to hiding.
To hiding, yeah.
And Sam said his biggest challenge in this movie was point of view, because sometimes it's always that thing of who do you stay on? Not the person talking, but the person who something is being revealed to.
Mm-hmm.
So, and of course the plot, they were worried about the plot. Polanski had never done this, a complicated plot like this, and just worrying that the audience wouldn't be confused. And Sam somewhat facetiously said, I still don't know what it was really about. but it was just, it was complicated. And what I love too, I wonder if you could talk again, Darrin, about why you love those kind of love scene, the kissing scene in the bathroom, why for an editor it's such a crucial, delicate, but also rewarding kind of scene to cut.
Well, there are a couple of reasons for it. I mean, I think the scene is obviously gains power once you know, after you've seen it the first time and you know what the reality of her story is, when you know what she's trying to hide, there's a great deal of empathy for what she's experienced. I mean, the sheer tragedy of that to me is always very moving in that moment. As an editor, my favorite place to be is just two actors who are looking at each other, and you get to play with expression and as you said before, like who are we looking at? The one who's speaking or the one who's listening? What are their eyes doing? You know, what are their faces doing? And are they avoiding each other's eye contact or are they seeking each other's eye contact? All of those things and they're down to just frames, right? You're really just playing with frames here and there to make the magic, you know, to make it really electric. And what's really like the moment that I love in that is when she's dressing his wound and she's focused on his nose and sort of expressing some concern, you know, for the pain that he must be in. And you can see his eyes are actually up. He's not paying attention to what she's doing in terms of her care for him. He's now focused on what's going on in her eye that's just noticed. And he's not looking, he's not making eye contact so much as he's looking at something he's discovered, like a flaw.
And I love it. I don't know if you want to call it a fake out, but it's kind of this great little surprise, because you think it's intimacy when he's talking about her iris. So it sort of delays the final satisfaction of the kiss. And then when she looks at his mouth, that's inviting him to kiss her. But previous to that, it's not the obvious looking in the eye. And then you and I have both different theories about the iris. The spawn, the iris. See, that's another, it's wonderful. Everybody can put their own, you know.
Well, I mean, I would say that your theory, which Sam sort of spells out a little bit in the book, obviously has a little bit more backing on it, coming as it did from the source, or very close to the source. I've always just looked at the iris, the flaw in her iris and her reluctance to talk about it as being rooted in her abuse, which is, spoilers, you know, comes from incest and the possible genetic implications of children being born to their grandparents, basically. But what's interesting though is that obviously someone doesn't get a genetic mutation simply because they've been raped. It would have to have happened generations before, which tells us that whatever is happening with Noah Cross and Evelyn, or whatever happened with Noah Cross and Evelyn, whatever is likely to happen between him and Kitty, it's not the first time. Like, this has been generations in the past, and which again then threads back to this whole history of Los Angeles and how the corruption and the betrayals are just passed on from generation to generation.
And apparently the fact that he goes through this major part of the movie with this bloody nose was not decided until after they started shooting. And Sam said he said it's so Polanski, but he also couldn't believe that he would do that. And when he was editing this love scene with this bloody nose, and you're also feeling like, isn't she gonna hurt him when she gets it? It's just the cringeworthiness of it on top of the romance. It has that complexity and sort of complicated emotions that's very much true to the movie and true to Polanski's work, and even the humor, the bizarre, everything. And this is such a beautiful period. I love that you find the tragedy and the beauty of this sequence, because it is just before everything goes wrong. And of course, she does get shot in the eye at the end too.
Right. Well, Polanski, you know, like a lot of filmmakers, certainly of that first half century of great filmmaking, was very interested in the eye. Repulsion begins with that title sequence, with the title Repulsion going across Catherine Deneuve's iris, which, you know, can be, I mean, you can feel a sort of homage to Un Chien Andalou with the razor going through the eye in that. Which is, you know, when you're watching a movie, when we're witnessing on a subliminal level or a subconscious level, we are aware of our eyes doing our work for us in that moment. And so when we see it bisected, whether literally with a blade or with text or something, it resonates, it hits a nerve, almost literally. That was something that he used a lot, and he used camera POV constantly.
Yeah, and I think we have to finish up, but I just wanted to say also, it was great to capture a scene that shows these two actors at the peak of their performance. The the vulnerability and the fact that it was written for Jack Nicholson in terms of his mannerisms, his the way he expresses himself is a perfect match. And then the Dreda Dunaway, a complicated woman. Sam struggled a little bit with, or quite a bit actually, with her readings and her inconsistent live readings, but ultimately realized her nervousness to cover up her secrets was an asset in her performance. And really, both of those performances were just incredible. And we really see
it
played out in this sequence. So thank you for choosing that. And thank you, Darrin, for being part of this. It means a lot to me.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you. Hi, Suzana.
Hello, well, Bobbie.
I am so thrilled to have you here for Sam's panel because you are the person who really knew him. He was a mentor to you. He became a dear friend. And it's just really warms my heart to have you talk about him. And I also wanted to say, you were pretty early in your music career when you met your career as a music editor when you met Sam. And you didn't know this at the time, but he told me later, and I told you much later, that he considered you in a league of your own as a music editor, that you there was no one like you. So I know you were surprised to hear that, but I just had to say that. So to rewind, let's go back to how you met Sam and how you got the job.
Well, first of all, what an honor to be part of this, Bobbie. And I wanted to thank you and thank you for sharing what you just said, because he was somebody that I revered as in every single respect. And he, because it was the beginning of my career, he really gave me the most essential tools to persist, to exist, and to pursue what I really love, because he gave me advice, but not in a way that Sam would never say it was advice. Those were life lessons more than anything else, because one could apply them to everything else, which I did in your life, and also a freedom to express and to say whatever you feel you would like to contribute. And this brings me actually to the first time that I dared entertain the thought of working on a film that he was editing. It was called Frantic, and Roman Polanski is the director. Ennio Morricone was to be the composer, and I was just starting as a music editor. But my fascination with European cinema, having the opportunity to maybe even transfer east from this Western world that I came to, Paris, all of that was... Sam was such a huge draw that with the help of a very close friend who was also Sam's assistant and friend and confidant and everything to all of us, Glenn Cunningham, urged me to actually ask to have a job. And I will never forget it. It was 1987, and I was coming to Paris, city that I always held in my heart, right from my interview and a big Manila envelope in hand from Zagreb, where I was just given the... admission into for a green card, and so to celebrate this event, I went to Paris. I was coming back to New York, but via Paris. And Glenn was already there and Sam was already there. And so among all our, celebrations, he said to me one day, now you have to come to a lunch with Sam. I had met Sam once before, I believe, and ask him the question, ask him that you would like to work on this film. That's it. So we went to lunch and just Sam, Glenn and myself. And we had, like you should everywhere. We had our little, the appetizer, a glass of wine or a drink that Sam would, prefer to the wine. Then the meal came and nothing. We were just talking about Paris and whatever, my green card. I don't even remember what. I was so nervous. And so the lunch was coming to an end. And Glenn hit me under the table, with his foot, and he said, if you don't, meaning if I don't do it now, and I thought I have to now. So I turned to Sam and I said, Sam, may I ask you something? And he turned to me with that, that kind of devilish charm. And he said, Suzana, you can ask me anything. So I asked, and then he said, of course. That was that. And a few months later, I was in Paris with a job with Sam and Polanski and about to meet Ennio Morricone. I mean, a highlight of highlights.
So what did you observe when you were with him in the cutting room? What kind of insights did you get from his?
There were a few, and they were very, they were, because he was very giving. You could always talk to him. He was always, he is the person, a team player who is, who includes everybody in his realm. He doesn't, there was a sense of collaboration and an openness of expressing what what your opinion is and what your, in any case, it was a very open forum. That's what he creates in his cutting rooms. And it's a beautiful way to work because it's contrary to what an opposite situation would do. Contrary to that, it actually gives you, challenges you more because you're expected to participate and you're expected to actually come up with an idea, or you're expected to say something and so you are more on your toes and thinking and researching and thinking about what you are doing and what you're offering. And so it's an incredibly creatively fulfilling situation, but also a very challenging one, which is good because you find that you could do things that maybe you didn't really think you could. And he opens this forum to that. And the first thing, what I learned from him early on in that cutting room, when he would see me struggle over a cut, because a music cut that was difficult to do, he would say to me, this is what I suggest and I demand, actually. Close it, close the machine, forget about the scene. Go home, have a glass of wine, have a nice dinner, come back tomorrow and it will be evident. And that was the first lesson, and it was so true. Because you get caught in a moment and you forget about the whole. And when you get caught in a moment, you are obsessing over a moment and you could actually destroy the meaning of the whole. And this is what then I learned next. One day I was in the cutting room. Sam was cutting at that time on an upright moviola. And so next to the moviola, there was always a rack onto which you put your reels and reels that were waiting for, that Glenn would prepare for Sam to and thread for him, and then would take off. And Sam was cutting something towards the end of the film, and he told me, look at the rack. I said, how do you decide and how do you edit and stay always true to the whole story, and how do you fight back that impulse that sometimes we all have to obsess? And he said, look at the rack. And I looked at the rack, and there were 10 reels, and they were all tails out. Now, the younger generation probably won't know what that means, but that means he never rewound. He just went forward. Every time he did a version of a film, a new cut, he would never look, he would always go forward. And then once he was done with it, that's when he would let Glenn unravel and unwind, and he would watch the whole film. And that was another incredible lesson.
Yeah, I when I was working with him, I saw that too. He never looked at what he cut, even when he would run for the director, unless it was a problem.
Yes.
And he said, you know, if I'm looking at the cut for the first time, then I'm fresh and I'm objective.
Exactly.
And that's gold, because objectivity is one of the hardest things to achieve in a creative process. And what you said earlier about going home and leaving it alone, his very first experience in a cutting room when he was an apprentice was Ralph Dawson was this old time editor, won 3 Academy Awards, Adventures of Robin Hood, Midsummer Night's Dream, a great editor. His name was Pappy Dawson to his crew. He was the head of the department at Warner Brothers. And he said, 2 pieces of advice, never wait for a picture. Take what job is offered to you. And after you start cutting the film, put the film on the shelf to let it heal. If you pick at a sore, it'll never heal. If you put it aside for a couple weekends, you'd be surprised how objective you'll be. And he always practiced that. And that's, you're very right, that's such a, it's hard to do it, but it's invaluable.
It's invaluable. And you're absolutely right, because when I remember now back, it's true. When he would do a cut, he didn't screen it for himself. He had Roman would come, and they would both sit in the cutting room. I mean, in the screening room, always the screening room. And that's how they would experience it. So Sam for the first time and Roman for the first time.
Your audience, which is something exactly. You'll never get again. It takes some courage, because.
Yes. Oh my God.
You have to be secure, but it's invaluable. There's another story that I love that you tell about Sam said he dreams about editing when he problem solves in his sleep.
Well, okay, so that was his famous line. And so everybody, you know, he was respected. And there was one day when he decided he wasn't going to go to lunch with us because he needed to dream. So about a scene, you know.
Or take a nap.
Yeah, right. Exactly. So we went out to lunch, and you know, there again, you know, the atmosphere working in Paris also taught me this, you know, this inclusion, we're all a team. So Roman would go with us. There was no separation of the, you know, of a certain hierarchy. You know, it was from everybody who was on the crew on that day in the cutting room would go out to lunch together, sometimes in the studio, sometimes out, depending on the menu, of course. So we went out with Roman and left Sam out, Sam back in the cutting room. So we come back about an hour or whatever later, and Roman, you know, opened the door, and there was Sam like this, you know, like. And so Glenn and I wanted to come jump in, you know, to wake him up, because we knew he was taking a nap and that was what he needed. But Roman said, psst, Sam is thinking. So we had to be quiet until he woke up from his nap.
He did say he was always jet lagged when he was in Paris. And in fact, the movie was once Roman thought of calling it jet lag.
Oh, really?
So to talk about the movie itself, and we're going to run a couple of clips, which is part of this story.
Yes.
So there, it was basically The Man Who Knew Too Much. It was a similar story. The wife is kidnapped, and it's all for some nuclear device, and it's all this intrigue. But there were problems with the ending. And can you explain the setup for how this screening came about? So the Warner's brass all were flying in for this new ending, right? The reshoot.
That's right. So what happened was that the Roman's original ending, and that both he and Sam were very much in favor of, was an unromantic ending in terms of the young girl, the ingenue of the film. But since she was this beautiful young girl, and with the American producers, it was very difficult to convince them that that there wouldn't be some kind of a romantic closure, rather than leaving her behind without a final goodbye, let's say, put it that way. And so after, you know, there were you know, other comments been that were solved in the editing room. I don't remember what, but this always kept on coming as a sore. And so finally Roman had to concede, and it was the winter. And the original was shot in the summer or early fall or something. So, and special effects at that time were not really, you know, there. So we were on an upright moviola, basically. So they had to go and, you know, because the scene was taking place in the cave on the Seine, where she is shot. They had to paste actually leaves on the branches of the trees, so it would kind of look like the same time that it was shot. So a lot of, you know, a lot of care and detail and writing, you know, and Roman trying to figure out an ending that would satisfy him and the studio. So a lot was expected of that, you know, of that scene, and money spent for whole reshoot, because they had to call in the main cast again. The main cast was involved in this new representation of the end. And so what happened, how should we do this, Bobbie? Should we show, should I tell the story? What should we?
So let's say, okay, so basically you were involved in preparing this scene, the reshoot. And I mean, all the elements had to be put together, including music. And so before the screening, you did that, you contributed, and now the screening comes for the reshoot.
Well, what was happening was actually all at the same time. So the reshoot was done. So I'll tell the story, then we'll show. Okay.
Yes.
So the reshoot was done, and now all this expectation. And all of Warner Brothers' heads, you know, Tom Mount as the executive producer, and then Warner Brothers studio executives all flying to Paris for this screening to see what they finally have, what they invested in to, you know, to see this beautiful new scene. And we already had done a mix of the old version. So now Sam, so while the screening, because, you know, it's not only about the, you know, once they had the ending, it was obvious that certain other things in the film have to be changed. You know, everything influences everything. You can't just insert a scene and think that everything else before it or after it will work the same as before. So you have to build to that moment in a certain way, but which meant recutting the film. But now they're arriving. We have a screening in the screening room in the studio at Boulogne. So reels are being transported from upstairs from the editing room to the projection is downstairs as the studio executives are sitting and waiting. So we're running, right? Sam is delivering his reel. Sam and Roman are still cutting. Sam delivers his reel to Glenn, who does the picture side. Glenn delivers the reel to me, and my job is now to take the old mix and conform it to this new picture. So that it's a chain, you know? So, and then an apprentice is running the reels down to the projectionist. So that we would have a continuum and me make it. We finally get to the last reel and, you know, and I'm conforming it. I did it. I give it to the apprentice who runs it down. And then I thought, okay, now we're all going to tiptoe into the screening room and watch, you know, this last scene, and I'm tiptoeing in first. After me will be, you know, they're still upstairs, they're following. So as I, and I, you know, quietly open the door so nobody would, you know, so they wouldn't hear me. And I sit down in the back seat. At that moment, when I sat down, I realized what I had done.
Let's run the clip.
This is what happened there. What I realized when I was when I sat down in that hurry and fury and, you know, and excitement and all of that, I forgot to put in the music and the dialogue for the new scene, rather conformed what was there before. And the old scene, the way originally that it was, she gets shot, Harrison Ford takes Betty Buckley into the boat, and they drive off with the boat down the Seine and home, and that's it. And she stays there on the. So now, you know, these executives expecting. Morricone wrote a new piece for this moment where Harrison Ford picks her up and carries this young little, you know, victim angel, beautiful thing off into the sunset, and I had the boat from the brrr, from them escaping from the old cut, and as that scene is starting, I hear the door crack, and Roman and Sam are walking in to watch this last scene and see the executive's reaction and, you know, be proud of it all and all of that. And so as the scene goes, I hear in the, you know, next to me, say, and that was Sam and Roman, because they laughing because it was pretty funny, but nobody else was laughing, believe me. And so the lights go off, and the producers, you know, they stand up and there Roman and Sam together in tandem, smiling, and Sam, I'm terrified. I ruined the whole thing, and Sam calls me in. He gives me a hug while Roman says, oh, don't you worry, Suzana will fix it right now. And we'll go get a, let's go get a coffee and we'll go back up to the cutting room and see the ending when she fixes it. I mean, they held me, they stood by me. They held me and they did not, there was never an inkling of blame, but they stood with their team. And that was the most beautiful moment in my career. I mean, I ruined, you know, like, this way, you know, I could have ruined the whole, you know, the whole somebody, it would have been a very different reaction if it wasn't Sam and Roman together. And I think that that's, you know, that kind of humanity they shared, because that kind of, you know, sense of humor comes from a very generous spirit and soul and humanity. They understand the human error and can actually relate to it and therefore can find humor in it. And that is the persistent quality, no matter what they're faced with. That was the most wonderful story that I keep telling and will keep telling forever.
Thank you so much. And let's run at the end of our panel. Yes. Let's run the final clip.
So let's do that.
This is what you want.
A little bit better. Or not.
Or not. Depends on when a comedy or a hard. Thank you so much for being part of this. It means so much to me, and I'm sure all the people that are going to be watching. So
thank you, Bobbie. This was an honor.
Thank you. I hope you all enjoyed this. It was an incredible ride for me. And I, as I said at the beginning, everyone was so different. And it was just fascinating to see all these reactions. And I just, I was chatting with people during the event and answered some questions. There was one particular question. Well, there was a technical question about the French camera and Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf. It was an eclair. Not a dessert, but a camera. And Karen Stern asked a question about Elizabeth Taylor's performance and that it was pieced together line by line, whether it was pieced together. Elizabeth Taylor was not pieced together line by line. She was remarkable. They were worried about her that she didn't have the chops for this. She was considered more of a movie star than a great actress. But she, you know, Mike was wonderful with actors and they rehearsed a lot. And she was also sort of playing herself in her marriage to Richard Burton. My favorite thing to talk about was actually asked by two people, Abdul and Philip, about the last scene in The Graduate. So I'm going to explain to you, talk about lucky accidents. This is a pretty amazing one. So Benjamin and Elaine are running towards the bus at the end. She's in her wedding dress. They've just escaped the evil parents, and they're designed for her to marry the makeout king, basically. And as they're getting on the bus, before they shot it, Mike Nichols said to Sam, I cannot be on the bus, because the camera swings around and you literally see everybody on the bus. So he said, Sam, you have to be on the bus, because he was too recognizable. He was famous as a Nichols and May and just in general. So Sam's sitting on the bus, and you can actually see him. If I was able to point it out to you, I could. We were running the footage, but at any rate, so they get to the back of the bus, and the way it was written in the script is they kind of laugh and they look at each other and they have this sort of winsome moment. And then the camera, you cut to, and this was shot through the back window of the bus, of these parents and all the people that attended the wedding running around like Keystone Cops. And then they kind of smile and laugh, and that's the end, and then the bus pulls away. But what happened was, as they're sitting at the back of the bus, Sam forgot to say cut. He wasn't a director, he just forgot. So now Dustin Hoffman and Catherine Ross are kind of don't know what to do. They're sort of hanging out a little, looking at each other tentatively. So when they watched, Sam and Mike saw that in dailies, they said to each other, what a great moment. Let's just play it all out like that. And that'll be the end of the movie. They never cut to the back of the bus and the point of view of the people at the church. They just stayed uncomfortably long on the two of them. And it was the greatest ending, because they're looking at each other saying, now what do we do? What this whole thing about what do we do with the rest of our lives? And it's, Mike even said at one point that he thought she was going to end up like Mrs. Robinson. But they didn't really know each other. And that people who watched it when it came out had numerous discussions about what does it mean? And this is kind of unsettling. And it made it more profound, because it put a deeper meaning into it, and you could read your own meaning into it, but their characters and their decision was much more complex. The parents weren't just the bad guys. This was their future, and they had questions and ambivalence. So that's the story of the end of The Graduate. I just want to say one more thing, because I just love that Sam had a lot of words of wisdom, but my favorite one of all was movie first, scene second, moment third. And what that meant was that is the order of importance for every decision you make when you cut a movie, meaning that everything has to be justified in terms of how it serves the overall movie. So that you can't hold on to a scene or a moment just because it was beautifully shot or the director loved it, or you have to always have that order of priority. And it's such a great thing for an editor to think about when they're working. So thank you again for joining this very long panel or series of panels, but of course we couldn't edit those panels because everybody was so wonderful. So you saw them in their entirety, and thank you again for joining us.
I think it's also important to know when not to edit. I think that was one of the themes tonight. Yeah. So we looked at our marathon event and said, we can't cut this. How could you possibly cut this? So, and when it's streaming, when it's archived, people can, they can watch a part of it. They can take breaks. But I was really glad to see this in one stretch and really, just get everything out of it. It was terrific. So thank you, Bobbie, for all of your time and your tireless research. And I want to thank Jason, Janet, and I know we have another event scheduled at some point soon. It'll probably won't be until next year, I would say, unless Jason's jumping up and down telling me that there's one coming up next week. But we'll be coming back out with another one soon. And I've heard some of the ideas that you guys have been discussing, and I'm pretty happy. He's texting, we have a color event on December 17th. So there you go. But we will be sending emails out. For now, great event. You know, can't believe you wore that shirt through the entire thing, Bobbie.
I haven't showered in all this time.
It's our pandemic panel, right? That's no one changes their clothes. Nobody gets up from that chair. All right. Well, have a great night. And I'm just so happy that we got to do this. Great.
Me too. It means so much to me, as you guys know. And thank you for supporting me and helping me do this. Thank you.
All right.
Good night.